Hello and welcome back to Just Casting. You're here with me, Kyle,
Alex,
and Jose.
And we're down Dave today, but we bring back our good friend Pat. Say hi, Pat.
Hi, Pat.
That's not funny.
That's the oldest joke in the book.
It really is. And simulcast / tin can cast / carrier pigeon messaging. We have live from the Soviet Union in 1985, our good friend Jared. How's the snow?
Oof, it's pretty deep here, Kyle. Global warming is not going to really kick in for another 5 years.
Well, I guess that's good. So the polar bears and stuff, they're pretty happy.
There's not even polar bears here. It's just death and cold. And there's a big stack of nuclear warheads with Soviet symbols painted on them. I don't know.
Are you telling the people that it's going to get better?
There's not even polar bears
along?
Here. It's just death and cold. And,
what is that?
And there's a big stack of nuclear...
What the hell
that was
that?
That crazy.
By the way, I said that like 15 seconds ago.
Yeah, for some reason it repeated.
Repeated again. That was awesome.
We're going to have to restart.
No. Oh. It's still recording on yours, though.
No, alright.
Hold on. You played it on your computer?
Yes.
What is wrong with you, Alex?
Why are you doing that while I'm recording?
Damn it, Alex.
Oh, that actually fucked up my computer. I'm sorry, but it's good on your computer. That's why we have backups.
You have to give me one video game from your collection to make up from that.
Fine.
I mean, there's probably a shitty one or thousand in this house.
All right, we'll just keep on going.
Yeah, no, why not? That was funny, I think.
I want Pong from Atari.
You can take my Pong, it's okay.
Didn't see that one coming, did you?
No.
Do you really have Pong for Atari?
No.
How do you not have Pong from Atari? You have an Atari 2600.
Pong for the Atari 2600?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's like that was the main attraction.
No, I'll make sure it was the Pong table, not the actual. Like, I don't think they actually made a cartridge for the 2600.
Yeah, they did. Pong was on a lot of things.
Okay, right.
I thought Pong was just like a two, you know, bit
it was an individual
download anywhere on your phone, on your laptop. Just, like, one
yes, because when it came out in 1972, there was
like
all sorts of laptops and phones coming
not
on.
Not on the freaking giant, like, bookcase computer.
Wait, Jared,
no.
Jared.
Yeah.
Does Tetris already exist in Soviet Russia right now?
Ooh, 1985.
No.
No, they don't believe in any fun.
Well, if you think about it, in its basics, Tetris is not fun. It's just putting pieces together how they're supposed to fit.
I know Mario Kit was released in the U.S. in like the late 80s, but was already out in
86.
Japan by like, it probably was.
No, if it's 80, no, even in Japan it was 86.
Oh, really?
Wow.
Oh, well.
But Final Fantasy was out.
Shockingly.
That was that new Final Fantasy game on the NES.
Shockingly. It's Final Fantasy 1.
Yeah.
Like, the actual one, not the remake of 7 that they're just calling 1.
Russia was super advanced on the Final Fantasy front. That was the only thing they had stock in.
They have a bunch of
this would be big
PCs. It's their Soviet way of thinking.
Yeah. So, anyway.
But speaking of video games, like, the recent release of GTA 5 has, like, been one of the biggest releases. In fact, that...
Is it, though?
I could care less, personally.
There was a lot of people...
But I don't think it made the money that everyone was expecting.
Really? If it didn't, I'd be surprised, but...
Well, no, I mean, compared to, like, the Call of Duties and the
and it wasn't gonna make those
Well, that's
numbers.
A franchise that has, like, a new release once every year. GTA has, like, one major... Well, I mean, look at...
Like
I was like, GTA is not that frequent.
Yeah.
No, I meant Call of Duty was new release every year.
Mm-hmm. I would almost argue that would make it less special, less people would buy it every year.
Yeah.
Like, new GTA should be a bigger event.
Yeah, it's really incredible how Call of Duty should just be studied, how it makes so much money. Like, it's unbelievable.
It is pretty crazy. And each game is not significantly different from each other.
That's
why it's
the same thing every year.
Got into buying, like, the latest release, you know, if it was, like, say, $60, why bother buying it now if just, like, a year from now they're going to come up with, like, the latest copy that they're going to, like, try to insist on you to buy, you know?
Well, Pat, it's funny you mention that because, believe it or not, I have never played GTA 4.
Really?
And I got it for $2.50 this year on the Steam sale.
Wait, $2.50?
Yes.
$2.50 with the expansion pack episodes from Liberty City for another $2.50.
I can never play those games on, like, a computer. I tried downloading San Andreas for my Mac, and, like, I just... I can't, the controls are like too different from like an Xbox.
That's why
controller.
You buy an Xbox controller that's compatible with a computer.
Yes, exactly. That's how I played Arkham City.
Yeah, it's a regular wired Xbox 360 controller will work on a PC or
really?
I think a Mac too.
I did not know that.
No, unless you dual boot it with Windows.
All right then. I wasn't sure.
The I don't know. The only thing I ever saw good about the Grand Theft Auto games is you just sit there and put cheat codes in and just fuck around the whole time. Like the game is kind of stupid.
All
it's
I ever
really
did was fuck around.
Like, if you have, like, unlimited, you know, if you could just heal yourself and make a jet and make a fucking, you know, rocket launcher, like, that's fun. But the game itself is pretty boring.
Depends on what
Yeah, I mean, it became very formulaic. Like, its stories became very good. But then once those kind of wore out, and I've never played 4, so I don't know how that goes as far as on
that
the new consoles,
very,
but it got
gangster.
Old.
And it was like, that's
four
not...
was very serious, very mafia-ish.
Yeah, and it's like, that's really, like, if you played 3 and Vice City, it was like, it's kind of silly. The whole thing.
Yeah, it was just fun. It's like, oh, and forget about it. If you play, like, 1 and 2 for
one
PlayStation
and
2 1.
Are not a real thing.
Yeah, have you guys ever played those, by the way?
I played the first one.
Like,
I downloaded
Nintendo games. Like,
yeah, I downloaded the emulator of the first one, and I was just like, what is happening?
There was a button just to burp and fart in those games. It's
crazy. Is that how it works? I was just like, I've not smacked one hooker.
Yeah.
I have. I don't know. It's from the bird's eye view. I can't tell.
You know what's interesting about GTA 5, and I haven't seen this since Final Fantasy 7, it came with more than one disc in that it'd be...
Games have come with more than one disc.
Oh, Mass Effect 3 came with more than
Halo
one disc.
4. Really?
Halo 4. And 3, if I'm not wrong.
No, Halo 3 was one disc, but Halo 4 was two
Oh, you know
discs.
What it was? I got, like, the Legendary Edition.
Oh, okay,
I think it came with a bonus, like...
Well, it was just an install. For GTA 5, it was an install CD.
Yeah, it's, like, 8 gigs to install.
I feel
install
like that's
GTA
actually
5.
Been happening recently.
Yeah, a lot of them. A lot of things have happened.
Yeah, because they can't fit the games. The
yeah,
game's too
big
and too advanced. They want to, you know... They
they're too advanced to fit on one
screen. Yeah, and the Xbox 360...
No, honestly, I forget. I don't know the specs. I can look that up quickly, but, like, the RAM in a 360 now is really shitty. It's...
Half a gig, really?
Of RAM, yeah. Compared to like,
it's a half, right?
What, the
it's...
Xbox One's gonna be 8 gigs of RAM?
Holy fuck!
Yeah, it was like giant memory and flash drives on Xbox anyway.
Well, RAM is dirt cheap now.
Yeah, it is. You can get
so,
RAM
they do their best, Jared.
No, but
those RAM whores.
Mass Effect, I saw when I was in GameStop, they got the whole Mass Effect saga, like Mass Effect 1 through 3, for only like $40 too, and...
Really?
Yeah, I've always had mixed feelings towards Mass Effect. I heard the second game was, like, a phenomenal. I played the first game, I
it
stopped.
It was kind of like, I've said this before on this podcast, and I will say it again. Any game that you hit an attack button, and then you sit back and watch the guy attack.
It's just the first game that does
that's
that.
That's shitty.
It became more of a shooter.
I hope so.
That's why
I could never get over that.
I didn't like the combat system of the first game.
Yeah,
that's
it was a little
stopped.
Odd, but...
Star Wars, Knights of the Old Republic. It's that engine, and
it's
like
a definite space opera, which is what I like. But I
oh
like
yeah,
Star
the
Wars.
Knights of the Old Republic.
It was an open world
too,
and that's what I really love about games. Like my favorite type of games are like the open world games. That's why I like Bethesda and like Fallout 3 and even GTA.
What was that first one?
Bethesda, they like make
Bethesda,
games
the
like
company.
Fallout and
the company. I was like, what
fucking
game?
Fallout 3 and Oblivion and
that company. I have played a total of maybe 15 to 20 minutes on all of their games combined. But I like that. I like the engine it runs on. I think it's fun. I think it's open. I like it. It's the closest thing you can get to what World of Warcraft would be fun playing as to me. But you were just saying Knights of the Old Republic was great. I can't stand Knights of the Old Republic.
It really? Was great for its time. I mean, it's one of those games where it's like you're watching a great movie
but
slash
make,
playing.
Make that
like
movie.
It's just
yeah,
it's one of those types of games.
No, make that movie because I played Knights of the Old Republic and I lasted about a half hour before I was like, this is fucking awful because you don't fight. You tell him to fight and he fights. That's not a game. That's
well, there's
that's an interactive movie.
There's a smidgen of strategy.
I'm
like
sure
you
there
can,
is.
It's all about leveling up your character.
You can level up your character. And, you know, you can use certain, like, attacks, and you can use
I am sure that's all true, and I'm sure the story is amazing. Make it a movie. Make it an animated movie. Don't fucking A video game is supposed to be a game you're playing. It's interactive. You're not supposed to.
It is. It's an interactive story. It's
characters.
Not,
has there ever been a video game like based adaptation film that was actually like really good? Because excuse me, it's just like makes me think like the
Super
Doom
Mario
movie.
Brothers.
Oh yeah, that was like Citizen Kane. But no, like
what are you talking about?
Games I'm talking about, like movies.
Games
wait, are you saying
Super
movies
Mario
from
Brothers.
Games or games
movie
from movies?
I love that movie.
It's a guilty pleasure movie. Shut up, Pat.
I'm totally lying. The movie's awful.
I'm gonna say, like, it's
awful. I wanted one person to jump to my defense.
No, you know what? I will say it, hand to God, I think it's a guilty pleasure movie.
Oh, it's an awful
movie. Okay. Once in a while, I will watch
it.
You as
a
Mario fan
movie.
Should be offended by that movie. That
Yoshi
movie
looks
so
Yoshi looks scary as shit. Yoshi. He's gonna, like, eat people.
I can't call myself a true Mario fan, for the record.
That's my favorite part, is Yoshi. Because if that was him in the game, I'd be way more into those games. Can you imagine you're on Yoshi's Island and there's a baby riding a literal raptor?
That'd be
and
badass.
And the little like mushroom people that are trying to kill her are just like, holy shit, trying to run away.
What do you mean mushroom people? It's like the toads or whatever, just like guys like shrunken reptile heads, and it was all
weird. That was weird.
And Dennis Hopper was Bowser, and they called him King Koopa by his original name or whatever. That's
that
like calling
was...
Mario Jumpman.
Yeah, but when that movie came out,
I heard somewhere that both Danny DeVito and Arnold Schwarzenegger were approached and turned down the role for Bowser.
Danny DeVito?
Yes.
Give me better Mario.
That would have been the greatest movie of all time. Oh, such a waste.
Well, what could have been that? Because that would have made the movie, let's be honest.
Well, they should have had, well, I mean, with those two guys, they should have had Danny DeVito play Mario and Arnold Schwarzenegger play Koopa.
Oh, that would have been amazing.
No, it should have been the twins reunion.
Yeah,
Schwarzenegger as
Luigi
and Danny DeVito as Mario.
Luigi's taller. We all know this.
Exactly.
Yeah, but he's not jacked.
Yeah, come on.
Yeah, he's not that much taller than Mario.
Maybe just have John Leguizamo play regular Luigi. Then Luigi gets like a mushroom and or a fire.
Turns
into
Schwarzenegger.
Yeah, turns into Schwarzenegger. Yeah.
Da-da-da-da-da. Oh, that'd be awesome. The Austrian Mushroom.
It's like what they did with the Hulk. They had Bill Dixby turn to Lou Ferrigno.
Yeah, because that was believable. Oh, it actually is if you watch the show. Yeah. I take that back.
I remember I made eye contact with Lou Ferrigno once, and he kind of nodded at me. And that was my claim to fame.
It was a gentleman's understanding.
Yeah.
Remember that time Adam West called you me?
Yeah, that was a weird time.
Wait, what?
I told you this story. Like, I was like 15 or 16. I was at not the New York Comic Con, the smaller one, the Big Apple Comic Con.
Oh, yeah. I remember that con.
And I went there, and I had this Batman comic. It was one from the 70s. And it was during the time of the Adam West show, because the cover was spoofing the Adam West show, mm-hmm. with Robin like saying, "Hey, Batman, we gotta get going. There's trouble afoot." And Batman's like lounging on the couch, being like, "Not now, Robin. I'm gonna watch myself on TV." And the TV shows The Adventures of Batman. And I managed to like buy like a very good condition copy of that particular comic, and Adam West was doing signings there. And I remember Adam West, he had these big like headlight aviator sunglasses, and he had this like Donald Trump kind of like blonde comb over haircut or whatever. And I just went over to him and was like, "Hey," and I waited in line, eventually got up there and said, "Hey, Mr. West, my name is Pat, like, check it out, this Batman comic." See, they're like talking about your Batman show, and I remember he was like, "Oh, I guess my show is so famous it got referenced in that." So he was just like, "So who do I make this out to?" He's like, "Pat." I was like, "Okay, here you go, Kyle." I was like, "Actually, Mr. West, my name is Pat." He's like, "I know it is, Kyle. Here you go." So
hey, was that the you see, Batman likes me better. Done. What?
Do you really want that Batman to like you better?
Any Batman.
Do
Batman,
you really
except
though?
Val I'll take any Batman except Val Kilmer and, that's it. They're all pretty good.
You think of Ben Affleck or not?
You know what?
Oh,
now that you mention it, I do respect
Adam
West a lot more than Val Kilmer.
I like Adam West. It was a different, you know, it was the first ever real superhero show. They didn't know how to do it.
They had Superman.
Yeah, well, non-Superman show. It was the first ever, like, let's make it fun. I like that Batman show.
Let's have Robin played by a 28-year-old man decades before it was actually happening.
I was going to say, yes, they've done that again since then.
I do have a random, even though we're not playing a game tonight, I do have a random trivia question for you guys that I found out recently, within the past couple weeks. Do you guys know what superhero was the first ever to
Captain
get
Marvel.
Any adaptation?
To never be asked.
Film.
Captain Marvel. Any...
Was it Batman?
I didn't hear. Did someone answer?
Captain America.
Captain Marvel.
Oh yes, that is correct.
Really?
He said it three times already.
Yeah, he did, but what?
I said it before you finished the question. You were waiting on that one, Kyle.
No, he said it three times. You
yeah, I said
him.
It when you were like, do you know what superhero?
Yeah,
got the first.
He actually said Marvel. It before you even finished the question.
Get that, damn it, Kyle. Let me finish the question.
Well, it was a TV show, yeah. Kind of serial thing.
It was released in theaters like in 12 episodes.
Oh, okay. It was like a whole rights thing. They couldn't get Superman or something, so they were like, "Let's get the closest."
Did they actually have like Billy Batson turning it to Captain Marvel? Did they just have Captain Marvel already?
I believe so.
Really?
I believe so. To be honest, I haven't watched it, but the entire thing's on YouTube.
Hmm. Apparently, the flying sequences were pretty cool.
Really?
Yeah, that's what I hear. Like they had him on a cool angle that actually kind of looked like he was flying.
Did they ever even show George Reeves flying a Superman? I remember him just like
punching through walls
all the time.
Yeah.
No, they did. They put him, but like that was really shitty. Like you could totally tell he was in front of a screen.
Oh yeah, like through the sky. Yeah, I actually do remember that. That was awful.
It was really bad, and they didn't do it a lot.
Yeah, that's why most of the time it was just him busting through walls, being like, "I'm here."
Yeah, right.
But getting back to Adam West, Batman, I was just thinking, I like to think that the scene where the Adam West Batman, if you're familiar with, he has this giant, like, cartoony bomb that's, like, about to go up. He's running around trying to get rid of it, and he's like, you know, some days you can't get rid of a bomb. I like to think that Christopher Nolan saw that scene.
I think I already did this on this podcast.
Oh, really?
Before.
And he turned
into, like, we discussed that that would have made the movie good.
Yeah, the giant waste of an opportunity. Yeah. The worst, the most... awful waste of a joke in history.
It really was. It was set up perfectly.
Because he could have done it, and nobody would have questioned it, except the people that would know what it's from, and they would have just been like, "Oh my god, this is the greatest moment of my life."
Right before
he takes off, he just turns to Gordon and Catwoman, and just like, "Some days, you just can't get rid of a bomb," and he just takes off and goes. Nobody would question it.
Christopher goes, "Oh my god, Batman was Bruce Wayne
the whole time."
That would have changed my entire opinion of the movie. I would have been—I could be completely honest with you.
It's weird. Like they released Dark Knight Rises on like HBO on demand. Yeah, like, they haven't done that with Avengers or anything.
Well, Avengers is on Netflix.
Yeah,
no, they're on. Yeah, Disney signed their rights all over to Netflix.
What
so
Star
if
Wars
you notice, if you notice, like Iron Man,
who doesn't own Star Wars?
I know, I was just saying.
Like, what money are they going to get? Yeah, I know, but you didn't see Star Wars till yesterday, so.
It's a few years ago now.
But still.
Thanks, guys. It's points that it's on Netflix. I own the movies like 5 times each, so, I mean, it's not going to
make any
difference to me.
Your favorite movie is episode 1, so you don't get an opinion
either. It was never from episode 1.
You literally told me that. That's
not
even a joke.
I did tell you that.
You are the only human being that defends the existence of Jar Jar Binks.
No, he did it to annoy me.
I did
to
annoy
him. But when we first met, you said your favorite movie was episode 1.
Maybe most of the because I was a kid, and I was like, oh, Jar
Jar. Yeah, I'm not saying why. I'm saying that's what you said.
I did not say that.
You were a poor, misguided child.
I mean, I've seen the old movies before the new trilogy, but that probably stuck in my mind the most when I was a kid, you know, because it had funny, crazy shit going on.
You know what stuck
time.
In my mind the most? Empire Strikes Back. This is the best movie.
Yeah.
When you're 7, you don't appreciate something like that.
In my, you know, since I've gotten older, I have grown a bigger liking for episode 4, but I still do think that episode 5 is the best one.
Well, I liked Jedi for... I like Jedi the best for most of my life.
Yeah, but Jedi, you could already tell, like, there was, like, the initial symptoms of George Lucas giving into, like, commercialism and trying to create characters.
What? Ewoks, you mean?
Merchandising.
What do you
mean?
Wait, you mean Ewoks?
But the Ewoks were fun, and they were fun, they were kick-ass.
What is it with you and Ewoks? Every time like I bring up that scene where the Ewok is trying to get his friend up.
Is there a sadder moment in cinema history? Then when one Ewok dies and the other one is, like, poking his buddy trying to get him up. That is the saddest moment in cinema history.
That is pretty depressing.
Yeah, not anything in Saving Private Ryan. When the one Ewok can't get up.
Not like, even a little bit.
Screw that opening scene in Normandy.
Definitely beats all the oven scenes from Schindler's List.
It does. You know about those things. Everyone... That's something we can't relate to. We can relate to, like...
Maybe the Ewok wasn't even dead. Maybe he was just in a coma or something.
Oh, that's a teddy bear over a human being.
Maybe the Ewok literally just scraped his knee.
Because that scene is more relatable than all that every scene in Schindler's List and every scene in Saving Private Ryan.
Oh,
you know what? I'll defend Kyle on that statement.
That is so fucking real. That
maybe
one
to
you
us,
watch,
but you go to the World
and,
War II.
Oh, back up. Listen to yourself. That is so fucking real. That
the,
one Ewok.
Yeah,
the concept
yeah,
the
so
honestly,
is so real.
I will defend Kyle with something that happened in my life when I was a child.
You met an Ewok?
Your furry bear friend.
No. No, like from the innocence of a child, when I was like 5 years old, my dog bit me in the hand.
Yeah.
And I was rushed to the hospital.
Yeah.
And the day after, my parents brought the dog to a shelter just for a couple of days.
Yeah.
We went to pick him up a few days later, and they said we put the dog to sleep. I was 5, so I just said, oh, I'll wake him up.
Uh-huh. Wait, they saw the body?
No, because
I
was
no, they did, I didn't know. They just, they just told me the dog was put to sleep.
Oh, okay. I was going to say, they had the body, and they let you see the body?
No, I never saw it, but just that was one of the most devastating moments of my childhood.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's like that concept of like saying, oh, I just wake him up, and then you realize, oh, he won't wake up.
Yeah, that's fucking awful.
It is.
We have no connection to getting people put in ovens. My family's Jewish, and that you can't imagine what that's like. That's right. So crazy. That's the same thing as being like, you know, the Joker just had a commercial about, you know, Smilex, and you know everyone's gonna die from Joker poison. It's the same thing. You have no relation to that.
I don't understand what you're talking about.
here's a way to explain it.
I gotta say, I don't know where you're going with that one.
Yeah,
either.
Next thing you're talking about Smilex.
Yes. I'm saying to us, the four of us here and Jared in 1985 in Russia, the closest thing, like, you might as well have, when you're talking about Schindler's List, you might as well be talking about the Joker doing something horrific. It's not real. It happened, but it's not real. You can't imagine that. You didn't see anything remotely like that. But everyone has that terrifying, sad moment when you're a kid or when you're growing up that there's something that happens horrible that you can't understand. And you're just like, this didn't happen. Poke, poke, poke. Get up, friend.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And actually, Doctor Who is a good way to...
I just rationalized that Ewok story.
You did.
I don't even care about you, Pat. But I saw Alex's mind change while he was looking at me.
That their suffering and pain is as real to us as the Joker.
Hey, my family's Jewish, and that's not what I said. I said, I know it all happened, it was horrific, but to us in this room, that... You've never experienced anything like that. It's as far away from you as if we're talking about the Black Plague. You know, it didn't happen in our lifetime. We have no relation to anyone that it happened to.
Yeah, we can better connect with little teddy bear people.
Yes!
No, I'm gonna defend Kyle even further with something that Stephen Moffat once said. He didn't say it. Matt Smith made a comment about it. How a lot of the monsters in Doctor Who are kind of based off psychological fears of a child.
Yeah.
So, because you can relate to those fears when you were a child...
Mannequins! That was the biggest fear when I was a child.
First episode? Really?
Yes!
You must have loved that first episode.
I know. I connected with that first episode.
Alright, who here watches The Twilight Zone?
I have, indeed.
Alright, guys. Do you realize we have to make Alex watch that episode of The Twilight Zone?
Oh.
Is there a mannequin episode?
Yeah, there is. But if you've seen the first episode of Doctor Who...
like the nesting and all that.
Yeah. He sort of got there. I can't. What? Mannequins?
Yes, mannequins. I had dreams when mannequins would come to life and, like, attack me.
You know what?
No
wonder it took you so long to watch Doctor Who. You were like, they might come back!
You know something? Alex, you know, that's like actually a perfect example. Like, it's those fears as a child.
Yeah, they're not rational.
But it's because you did have those fears that they attract you more. You relate to them more.
Uh-huh.
And that's the thing of the Ewok deck that is. You relate to it more because it can happen.
I mean, I don't.
Well, I mean, mannequins coming alive won't, but it just brings you back to a psychological time of a child, and that just makes it scarier or harder.
The Ewok
whatever.
Thing is just like you're sad because your friend's dead.
Yeah, but you think he's alive. You're trying to wake him up.
Yeah, I guess he thought he was alive. I think he was
for
more like come on, we gotta go.
To be fair, like the Ewok that tried to wake the other Ewok up knew that, like, that they had just been in an explosion or something by, like, the storm. And another thing, too, the Ewoks took down, like, at least 20 stormtroopers, too. That's something a bunch of Jedis couldn't do in Episode 3.
One Jedi did that in Episode 3. Like, do you remember that badass Jedi kid that's ironically that George Lucas' son. Son
yeah. Really? Of course.
Huh. But he takes down like 1,000 of them.
He took down like 5.
He took down like 6.
Six, 1,000,
same thing. But he was impressive. I liked him. But I mean, look at Yoda and Obi-Wan. They raped the shit out of everyone.
Well, I hope they did. They're
well,
Yoda
of course,
Obi-Wan.
They're the leaders of the Jedi Council.
Yoda is. Obi-Wan was barely on the council. He was at the council for like 2 years.
He was a master, at least.
Yeah, he was a Jedi.
He was
yeah.
a master. All right, fair yeah. enough. He's not the leader, but you have a leader and a Jedi master.
Master Anakin, they got all syringed. What are we going to do?
Stop it. That's not the line, if you know it.
You chopped on me bloody arm, you did.
Stop it.
Master Skywalker, there are too many of them. What are we going to do?
Apparently, of course, someone has Cockney accents.
That scene was awful.
That was the best scene ever.
Poor kids.
That's the scene.
Poor younglings.
Poor kids.
And another thing, how could Luke master Jedi abilities in maybe 2 years in the...
I think it was like 5 or 6.
It was like 3, maybe.
No, I think between 1 and 6 is... I mean, 1 and 6. Four and six is, I think, 6 years.
Yeah, whatever. Still. Still think it was...
Well, he didn't master... If he was to fight someone like, you know, Yoda or Dooku or Obi-Wan, he would get his ass kicked.
Right. Well, you know, and, yeah, when you see that fight with him and Vader, you know, he's not kicking Vader's ass. Like,
and also,
not...
Vader's holding back because it's his son. He just is.
Right. Yep.
Two, Vader's not as strong as Anakin. He's stronger with the Force, but lightsaber-wise, not nearly as strong. He can't move as fast.
Yeah. Yeah, because he, like, Vader, like, as you know, like, he's dying, you know, throughout the years. Like, he gets weaker and weaker.
Old,
so by that time, he actually is pretty damn weak.
Yeah, he's stronger
in comparison
physically,
to the other Jedis.
He's stronger physically. If you punch you in the face, it hurt more. And if he used the Force, you know, the dark side of the Force, he's stronger. But,
well, he could just mind trick you and be like, that punch hurt.
Exactly. No, he could. He literally could probably have been like, you'll throw yourself down the pit, and Luke could have just jumped out. Like,
shouldn't his Vader's cyborg attachments decrease his midichlorian count?
No, midichlorian, it's in every single cell.
Yeah. I don't even like midichlorians. I was just bringing that up.
Really? You don't like midichlorians?
I don't like them. You're saying they're canon.
They're like my favorite thing. I remember when I was watching episode 1.
Nobody
so likes
midichlorians!
Why would you even need to specify that?
Whatever.
Jose and Alex, where do you stand on the midichlorian, anti-midichlorian act?
Do they even reference
the fuck is a midichlorian?
Do you really not know what a midichlorian is?
I might know, but I don't know
you
exactly.
You know how the
thing? There's nothing that combats that theory in 4, 5, and 6. I don't see the problem with it.
No, okay. Because 4, 5, and 6, the Force was a mystical force. Okay, it was a magical, and it was God, essentially. It was the Force that binds us, penetrates us, keeps the universe together.
Okay.
When you said penetrates, I just thought,
Is that your interpretation, or is that the actual definition of a Force?
No, Obi-Wan Kenobi says that.
Okay.
And he's a wizard. It's a magic in 4, 5, and 6. It's not science. It's the thing that comes up over science.
Well, isn't most things behind magic have a scientific reason to it?
Magic doesn't exist.
In movies and shit. They don't have scientific reasons why magic exists.
But it's their religion. It's this mystical force that has nothing... You know, the Scottish guy in the Death Star that's just like, oh, Lord Vader, you and your mystical religion. Like, you're crazy nut job, and then... Vader chose
I
him.
Find your lack of faith disturbing.
Exactly. But he... And then in episode 1, they have this weird revelation that it's like...
This bacteria.
It's not even... It's like... It's cells in bacteria that make up your body that give you a... They argue it's not just the midichlorians. Midichlorian count is your relationship to the Force.
It's like theta levels from Scientology, sort of.
It's very similar. But it's thetan, by the way. But it's basically like the more midichlorians you have, the closer connection you have with the Force. But they made it sound very weird, clinical, and scientific, where originally it was very mystical, spiritual, and cool.
Right.
Did they even reference that tidpoint of midichlorians after, like, Qui-Gon brought it up in episode 1? Because I don't remember any other scene...
No, and you know what? They didn't even mention it in any of the stuff afterwards, like any games or TV shows.
Yeah,
it was never brought up again.
It was not a very high.
And yet, there's actually data on that. Like a normal human would have 2,500 per cell.
Yeah, all right.
To a much higher level of Jedi, and then Anakin had 20,000 per cell.
Yeah, he did have 20,000 per cell. But Jose, unless George Lucas wrote what you're reading, it doesn't count.
Yeah.
It's the Star Wars.
Yeah, that's so true.
So it's gotta be based wait.
Are you on Star Wars Wiki?
Yeah.
That's not the Star Wars Wikipedia. Star Wars Wikipedia is Wookiee.
Oh, no, it says Wookiee, the Star Wars Wiki.
Okay, right.
Who's behind Wikipedia is more credible than Star Wars Wikipedia.
But here's the thing, like,
Wikipedia,
you know,
I used to spend so many hours on Wikipedia, just reading people's bios.
But anyway, but, you know, the people who write this stuff, they generally base it off some form of canon or the books.
Well, no, but the thing is that there's only 6 movies that are in canon. There will be 9 soon.
Right.
The canon consists of 6 movies.
Okay, then.
What about the animated series, like Clone Wars?
That's not in canon. I mean, it happens, and you could probably, maybe you can consider it canon. If you ask George Lucas, he might say yes. Probably, but the strong. Only thing, yeah, he's like, what? What TV show? What? And yeah. He just throws money at you and makes you leave.
Right. He did approve that story, The Force Unleashed. But yeah. It's technically not.
He approved that?
Yeah, it's not canon.
That's the one that's most out
no,
there.
No, he did. Yeah, no, I remember Vader that was like a big deal when the game came out, that George Lucas, like, said this happens
it's
in
shitty,
between
though.
3 and 4.
It's, that doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, the guy kind of looks like a generic anti-hero. Anyway.
Hey, that's what the guy actually looks like, the actor.
An asshole.
The guy played,
yeah, that's, he was Doomsday in season 8 of Smallville. But, and he's up, but more importantly, he's on Being Human. A really good sci-fi show. Yeah. But what is his fucking name? This is gonna bug the shit out of me. I really like that guy.
Many times.
Sam Witwer. Mm-hmm. No, but that they literally digitized him, and that's what he looks like.
Alright, well.
And he did all the actions, he did the voice, like he was every he
well he gets
character.
An A for effort. But.
No, he loves Star Wars. He played Darth Maul in the Clone Wars.
What?
Cartoon.
Oh, I thought it was Darth Maul in like the movie. I was like, that's the other guy.
That's Ray Park. No, but he did the voice of Darth Maul in the Clone Wars cartoon because he loves
Star
Wars.
Yeah, they brought
so
back
much.
Darth Maul.
It was weird. He was like psychotic. I liked it because he was psychotic.
Darth Maul
said
maybe like 4 words.
Yeah, I was like, do you have more than 2 lines in the Clone Wars?
And he also only died in one movie, which kind of sucked.
What was that?
He died in one movie.
Yeah.
He didn't get multiple appearances.
I mean, he wasn't.
Even Jar Jar Binks got multiple appearances.
Yeah, I mean, barely. But he wasn't even, you know, he was a throwaway villain. They wanted to just introduce the idea of a Sith. And they wanted to give Obi-Wan a cool kill.
Mm. Yeah. Darth Maul and Qui-Gon Jinn are, like, the only good parts of, like, episode 1.
You mean the 2 people that die?
Yeah. Pretty much.
Yes.
I mean, like, there are always good characters like ones that die. I mean, just like a Game of Thrones or whatever, but, like...
Don't stop it with the Game of Thrones.
I said it once. Jeez, calm down.
No, I just hate people throwing that out as a common pop culture reference for the minute.
Well, it's grafted into pop culture.
It's gonna go away in 2 years. No one's gonna care.
Still be on the air.
No one's gonna care though. Look at True Blood. True Blood was huge 4 years ago.
It was huge for the one season. It was actually a horror TV show. Then it got really shitty.
Yeah, nobody's gonna care about Game of Thrones. It's not a cultural mosaic. It's not a cultural.
You
a
sound
fan.
Like that guy who canceled Doctor Who in the '80s.
Yeah, that's exactly what it was. Because Game of Thrones has been on for 2 years, not 30.
The books have been coming out since like 96.
96? Wow, that's crazy. it's gonna be over.
I sense sarcasm in that.
Yeah, it will have its fans. It's not gonna be Harry Potter. It's not gonna be Lord of the Rings. It's not gonna be Doctor Who. It's not gonna be any of them.
I do find. I mean, it is a really good series.
I mean, it's probably fantastic.
That's another interesting thing to study because I will say the way it's actually grasped the general public is truly remarkable.
I know
because it's
because
not
like,
an easy thing to get into. I had to read that book like twice. Watch that first season like 4 times before I actually gave a shit. Like it can be tough. Like it's not an easy thing to get into. I'm really amazed at how people have really just jumped on that bandwagon.
And they can't hold on to it. It's not it's not the show, and it's not the show that will keep an audience for that long.
It has spectacular reviews. It is a good show, but I mean it's just exploded. I can't believe it.
Yeah, I know, and that's stuff that comes out this fiery and this long, like. It doesn't last. It's just gonna disappear. Like, look at Twilight. I'm not comparing the two because one is clearly superior, but like Twilight's gone. Like it's over and nobody cares about it anymore.
Well, Twilight in a way spawned 50 Shades of Grey.
But who cares about that? It's just weird.
Well, that's
like,
very true. Well, I mean, I think in time, what's good will last through time. So
exactly,
it will be interesting to see how Game of Thrones stacks up, and I think it will stack up. But it
by
is
the way,
just,
Jared,
just
1 second. I just gotta answer Alex's question. 50 Shades of Grey was a fan fiction originally written by some dude based off Twilight characters.
Was it really? I did not know that.
It was, yeah.
I didn't know that either.
It was, yeah, yeah. It was originally supposed to be like Edward and Bella or something.
Please don't remind me that series even exists.
Twilight or Fifty Shades?
Both.
Okay.
More so Fifty Shades because I was compared to Christian Grey one time. I don't know.
How is that a negative thing? Yeah. I'm weird.
It was weird, especially because of who compared, who called me Christian Grey.
I can gather.
Yeah.
But.
Still I think we need clarification on that.
No. You know, Jared.
Let's keep it ambiguous.
I don't want to put all details on my personal life in this podcast yet. I'm not drunk enough for that.
It was Doyle.
Exactly. Yeah.
It was Doyle.
Like,
he even could make that reference. Actually, he might be.
He might.
I'm
not 100% sure, but I think he might have read the first one.
Wait, Twilight? No,
Fifty Shades of Grey. I think we have.
There's multiple books?
Yeah, there's like a bunch.
There's three.
So, what are they? Are they all called Fifty Shades of Grey?
I don't know. It's like 100 Shades of Black. And
no, it was.
Shades of Off White.
25 Shades of White, 25 Shades of
Black. It's in the back of my head, honestly.
That's all right. Don't strain yourself on that, for the love of God.
Anyway.
J.K. Rowling's writing a new spin-off thing in the Harry Potter world.
Yes!
That's right.
Only information released implies that it's based on one of her other books. You know the title.
Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them!
Exactly, yeah. So
it's a textbook that's in Harry Potter. It's one of the books they read in school. And it's about the author and his adventures finding all the different magical creatures. And it's going to be so good. His name is Newt Scamander.
This is exciting.
Well, you said it's exciting.
Mm-hmm. That is actually a very good idea.
I'm so happy. I'm so happy they're keeping it alive.
Yeah, I love it.
It's weird, though, because it's not a based off of, well, it's kind of based off a book. It's like they came out that weird little packet at Quidditch Through the Ages and Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them. But there's no real book this is basing off of. She's writing a screenplay, which she's never done. All the Harry Potter movies were written by, like, Steve Clovis or something.
Really?
Yeah, she never wrote a screenplay. This is her first time writing a screenplay, and it's an original thing in the wizarding world. So it's kind of weird, because, you know, I always considered the Harry Potter books and the Harry Potter movies separate, because they're kind of different.
Right.
You know, they leave out a lot in the movies, and it's kind of a different story, especially the last one. Like, Harry, you know, can sense Horcruxes and do all these weird things, and the story is just a little different. But now she's adding to the movies without adding to the books, which is very confusing.
Right.
But I guess Warner Brothers couldn't let the series die, seeing as they just opened up, like, 15 theme parks based on it.
Yeah. I just didn't want to go for, like, prequels, like, Voldemort's Days and Hogwarts or whatever.
I would read and watch the shit out of that.
Yeah. Oh, like, Dumbledore growing up.
I would watch that 1,000. That is my ideal movie. That and the Yoda movie are my ideal movies.
Yoda growing up.
That's happening.
They're making a Yoda movie?
Yeah, they announced also this week, it was kind of speculated for a while, and, like, heavily rumored, like, this is happening, but Disney announced this week, or I think it was this week, that when Episode 7 is coming out in 2015?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's starting it, but after that, every year there's going to be a new Star Wars movie.
Yeah, they're going to do exactly what they did with Marvel. Like, they're going to have the 3 movies, and then they're going to have movies for each character, you know, each important character.
Well, that's not what they did with Marvel, though. Like what they did with Marvel was built up a bunch of characters and, like, sent them into Avengers. This is...
Okay, similar to Marvel's situation.
Not really. They do Episode 7, which is old people, like, you know, Han, Leia, and Luke. And then they're showing, like, Yoda's backstory. I've heard Han's backstory, maybe Boba Fett's backstory.
Yeah, Han Boba Fett movie, like, when they were younger or something.
I mean, I think together, that'd be weird.
Yeah.
Like, they were...
I don't know. There were some pretty hinting innuendos in some of those movies.
Yeah, he threateningly pointed his fire, like, flamethrower at one point. Yeah, Boba Fett's cool, but that's really, like, all he does. He just, like, captures Han, then points his flamethrower menacingly at one point.
Paul, you're missing a very big portion of Boba Fett when he gets his ass kicked in Return of the Jedi.
He escapes, though, like, he had that thermal grenade. That's in, like, the expanding universe.
That didn't happen. We'll see what happened.
We'll see what happened.
I don't condone expanded universe. You know, it's all fan fiction to me.
You know what's funny? Just looking back and seeing Jango Fett, like
Jango Fett Unchained.
Yeah, exactly. Like Samuel Jackman when you chops off Jango's. Jango Fett's like head is like Jango, you uppity son of a bitch.
Have you heard he wants to come back? Samuel Jackson.
Oh, no. Really?
Yeah, he wants to come back. And I've heard they're sort of trying to be like, dude.
No.
You got your hands cut off, and you got thrown out a window by getting electrocuted. You're dead.
I don't know how real the source was, but like they said, he offered like he could come back as a ghost. An android of himself.
That's exactly what he said, because they were he wanted to come back, and they were like, "You're dead," and he was like, "Wow, you know." It's like, we already have you in the Marvel universe. We don't need you over here.
Yeah, really. Yeah.
Right. Right.
He came up with the idea for the purple lightsaber, allegedly. Well, apparently, which I could believe, which is cool.
I think they probably didn't like it. Because they were very strict on the blue and green situation.
The old Star Wars was, like, white until they settled on, like...
No. That was, like, when they... That was the first minute before they were able to colorize
it. Yeah, right.
Well.
It was pretty...
Even later in blue. Even later in that movie, it was blue. Yeah.
I distinctly remember the lightsaber being white at one point.
Yeah, you know, when he pulls it out on the Millennium Falcon, teaching. Oh, no, and also on Tatooine, you're right. It's sort of white, it's green sometimes, it's blue sometimes, it's white sometimes. But by the end, by the fight with Vader, it's blue.
Yeah.
It's just blue.
It finally decided what it wanted to be.
Which, if anything, just means that Luke's lightsaber is all conflicted and Obi-Wan's is just blue.
Oh, that's why he has the green one in Return of the Jedi, because he drops the blue one.
Yeah, he loses it. He has to build a new one.
It's all coming back to me.
Well, I thought it was the same lightsaber episode 4, like, is that the same lightsaber?
Episode 4 and 5 are the same lightsaber.
Yeah,
you lose it
in between Luke and Obi-Wan and episode 4, same lightsaber.
No, they've not. No, Obi-Wan has his own lightsaber.
He does. I thought you just showed him his.
No, Luke has Anakin's lightsaber from episode 3. Right.
Yeah.
Remember when Obi-Wan and Anakin are fighting at the end?
Yeah, yeah.
Obi-Wan picks up his lightsaber.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then lies to Luke, like, your dad wanted you to have this. Your dad who doesn't
really
know you exist. Don't tell him, though, because he'll kill you. He's a crazy psycho.
What was his rationale for not telling Luke that Vader was his dad again?
Because he's a crazy psycho. Remember that time he chopped up those children?
Yeah,
that's kind of a valid reason.
Hey, they are younglings.
Fine, remember that time he chopped up those younglings? That doesn't make it sound better. It was a tragedy. You were the chosen one. I actually really liked that scene. I loved that whole ending fight.
Yeah.
Well, all right, let me tell you something about that scene that I find. Now, that scene actually is one of the cooler moments of that movie. But what really drives me nuts about it is when, after Obi-Wan says that whole emotional speech about how he was the chosen one, Anakin just goes, "I hate you!"
I love that. I think that's really good.
I think that's
kind of cheesy, and it makes him sound like a prepubescent teenager.
Yeah, that's sort of what that's why he falls for all this, because because you're when you're in the Jedi, you're not really gonna mature the right way. You're not allowed to, like, you have a master. You have a parent that's like your eternal parent for a while.
You think it's that or Hayden Christensen's acting?
No, it's not Hayden Christensen's acting at all.
Oh, it's both.
No, it's not. If you watch him in what's that movie? It's like Shattered Glass or something. He's a pretty dope actor. He's
you think
fine.
Is it the direction he was given to act like a little bitch?
Star Wars, do you understand the budget and the amount of people and the amount of money that was riding on Star Wars?
Oh, yeah, totally.
Do you think the director is going to be like, do you think George motherfucking Lucas
is going to be like, Skywalker, right?
is him going to be like whining and be like, hey, let's do another one? Let's do another take and be like, hey, Hayden, less whiny? Like, or in episode 2, when he starts to be whiny in the first place, you think he would be like, hey, I have $100 billion. Let's just replace him with someone better. Mm. It's all the script and all Lucas.
Yeah, uh-huh.
So, yeah, I think I have a feeling like he saw something in Hayden Christensen, but...
I don't hate Hayden Christensen.
It just didn't... I don't hate...
There are moments that I really like him.
Dislike him, but
do you deny that his
like
acting
it's almost like
him?
I don't know. I could be sounding wrong here, but it's like he tried to make the character a little too complicated emotionally.
Yeah, which originally he's the least emotionally complicated character of all time, Darth Vader.
But I will say, going back to episode one, now, this will be curious to get your guys' opinions on this. Is it just me, or is the only thing you really need to know about episode one going into episode two, the only thing you need to know to be caught up to speed on, is that Anakin really liked his mom?
I mean, is that odd, though?
What else would someone who missed episode one need to be brought up to speed on, who's already a Star Wars fan?
Anakin was prophesied to...
He has lots of midichlorians.
Even though Yoda said that he sensed the darkness in him, and Qui-Gon vouched for him, and Obi-Wan was uneasy, but then...
He was a really good pod racer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you seen those, like, videos of present-day Jake Lloyd? He is a shell of a man.
He looks a little weird.
Pat, I'm sensing some sarcasm.
No, like, he's, like, completely hollowed out. Like, years... of abuse from, like, people ridiculing
him. Oh, yeah, I've seen interviews. I feel like
fun
of you all the time.
To be fair, I think he's way worse than Hayden Christensen.
He was a kid.
Because
of course he was.
There are a lot of really good kid actors.
Yeah, he was actually a pretty terrible actor.
But again, I think it's Lucas. I think it's mostly Lucas. Him, just, like, having that kid act like, wow, R2, look at this happening, like... It's like, that's not what we're here to watch for.
This is so fun. And like,
I don't think he ever said yo.
There were no yo's on Tatooine.
He didn't say yo. He said yippee! Woo!
And him like accidentally blow up the not Death Star, quote unquote.
Yeah.
It's like, do you remember how Luke blew up the Death Star? It was like, it was faith and... Yeah. You know, his targeting computer wouldn't work, so he had to put faith in his soul and, you know, everything that worked and magic and happiness. I'm accidentally shooting shit! Like,
Let's not forget that hole was no bigger than a Womp Rat.
You know what?
I loved Mark Hamill and Robot Jr. like, yeah, I blew up the Death Star with my eyes closed. You guys can do this.
I shoot Romp Rats with my T-18 in my backyard all the time.
T-16.
Oh, God.
Maybe the point he was getting across is like, Luke... just is a complete better person than Anakin ever was.
No, he wasn't. That's the thing.
Anakin was the best person.
That's the point.
Anakin,
he's never the best.
Anakin is
Christ. He's the one who falls and rises again at the end to be the one that actually saves the universe.
He grabs the Emperor
and chucks him down the hole.
Lucas just had something going on with the character of Anakin that I just didn't pick up on.
I think he never thought about Anakin Skywalker before he had to write the prequels. I think he wrote Darth Vader and was like, he was a great guy back in the day. Like, and that was his, like, basically his synapse.
He already had the Clone Wars in mind. Like,
that's true, though. Like, that's his own character. Like, think about it. When you write Darth Vader, how are you going to write him as a child? Like,
yeah.
You can make him a badass child, but that's kind of cheesy. It's like, okay, he's a child.
Like Damian,
but then you make him, like, an actual child, and it's like, all right, how is he an actual child? It's Darth Vader.
Yeah, it's rough. You make the most badass guy in the entire universe. And then you're like, how do I turn him into a kid?
Yeah, it's that. I will say that is rough.
Like,
and then you turn him into this fucking whiny bitch of a teenager who's like, I hate you.
But that's a teenager. That's a teenager. That's like
dinner.
That. His best friend is his dad and uncle and brother and mother and everything. Like, it's, you know, Obi-Wan. Of course, he would hate Obi-Wan in a way. Obi-Wan was his parent, his everything. He was the guy that he had to answer to, or else, like, what, he's going to go back and be a slave or something? Like,
Jedi. I think with all those powers he picked up at the Academy, I think he could get away from slavedom.
I'm aware, but I'm saying he's a Jedi. That's his thing. Like, Jedi follow their masters. And Obi-Wan was sort of, you know, to a free spirit like Anakin, Obi-Wan was sort of restrictive. Obi-Wan was the essential Jedi.
Hmm. Yeah, I just think that. Yeah, I see where you're coming from. I just find that
Alec
Guinness.
Yeah, didn't Alec Guinness like dislike Star Wars and tell Ben to get a life when he asked for an autograph?
Years later, when people were like, "Oh my God, Star Wars!" He's like, "I'm 90 years old. I've been in 1,000 movies. I'm one of the premier British actors of all time." And you're like, "Oh, Star Wars!" Like. Yeah, he was probably pissed because he was only known for being in Star Wars when he was one of the best British actors of all time.
That is true. Well, that's Shatner's claim to fame, too, the Get a Life speech.
Well, Shatner can go to hell because he can only rely his career on Star Trek. Like, that's
was in 4 very good episodes of The Twilight Zone.
Oh, you're right. And also that show, Boston Legal, which we all watched because he was in Star Trek.
I've never watched an episode of Boston Legal.
Yeah, me either.
I like the Price God Negotiator commercials.
Oh, yeah, right. How can we forget about those?
And... yeah.
That now the superior Kaley Cuoco is in.
Yeah, exactly.
Because we're all much happier to watch her.
Chandler's old, too. He doesn't look it, but like he's really like in his 70s or late 60s.
Kind of looks it.
Hold on. I'll look this up quickly. I'm pretty sure he's in his 80s.
Really? Wow. He looks like he's in his 60s, but not 80s.
Apparently, recently, I'm only getting this from another podcast, but apparently him and Adam West recently had a... I forget what con it was.
82.
He's 82. Thank you, Alex. Apparently they did a Q&A together because they never. Apparently they've been friends for years, and like it's well known they're like good friends and hang out.
Mm-hmm.
And they've never done a Q&A together, but they were both on massive shows in the 60s.
Yeah,
and so they did a Q&A together. It was this giant, like, you know, crazy thing that people got to talk to them together, and they would just tell stories from the time and all this stuff. And it was this amazing, awesome moment.
That sounds interesting, at least.
Yeah, yeah. You could have gone, and they could have talked to me through you, because they only acknowledge you as me.
Yeah, of course. It's great.
I agree with Jared. I don't think he looks anything close to 82. I think it looks like he's in his 60s.
Yeah, yeah. He is impressive.
Right.
Yeah.
He is.
He's like the Tom Cruise of old guys.
Yeah. I think it's interesting how Tom Cruise is like, he's still managing to keep his career alive. Like,
no, he's not.
Well, he's still, like, starring in... I didn't say the movies were good. Struggling. He's still, like, starring in movies. He's got that new Power Armor movie coming out.
What?
It's, like, a movie where he's, like, wearing this exoskeleton. It's, like, he's doing a lot more sci-fi roles, and he's wearing, like, this...
Because Oblivion did great.
Yeah, I know. I didn't say they were good movies. I'm just saying that, like...
I'm sorry, but you said exoskeleton? Have you seen the RoboCop trailer?
I have not. Yes. But I heard it was meh.
Who said yes?
I said yes.
Oh, okay. What do you think, Jared?
It definitely, I'm pretty excited for it.
I don't know. Because it's not RoboCop. It's not the funny, wacky, like, action.
No. There's none of that.
RoboCop was pretty goddamn wacky. But I love the look. Like, they even show him in the trailer. I'll show you it later, Pat. But they show him, like, you know, same story. Cop gets, like, injured, needs to get put into robotics, whatever. But he has the original RoboCop suit. Mm-hmm. And he's just like, no, that looks too 80s. And they, like, and they like revamp it and make it look like...
Oh, yeah.
They do stuff like that all the time, like reference like the original thing.
It was funny, though.
Yeah.
It was really funny. I liked it.
I just think this, like, it actually looks cool, but it's definitely interesting to see. Well, because a lot of people are going to see it who haven't seen the one from the 80s. Yeah, so
I hope they do it with some humor, though. If it's just a straight up, like, action it's movie, it's gonna be worthless.
So is the guy still Murphy, or is he, like, a new version of Murphy?
That's a good question. I don't know. I don't know his name.
That's, like, one of the iconic RoboCop things. You know, he's just like...
No, I agree. I actually don't know that. Let me,
Yeah, he is Murphy. Vamp.
Oh, he is? Cool.
Yeah.
Now, Hollywood really needs to stop making remakes of, like, all these things. Maybe if they're good movies, they're good movies, and that's cool, but, like... A little originality with, like, you know, they're making this isn't necessarily Hollywood itself, but this is just an example that my friend brought to my attention. They're giving Patrick Bateman from American Psycho his own television show. So, like, they're taking up, like, Norman Bates, Hannibal Lecter, and now Patrick Bateman all have their own
TV.
To
be fair, Hannibal is fucking unbelievably cool. That show is awesome.
It's because they got that guy Simon Fuller, or Brian Fuller, like.
Yeah, he does it also. And Mads Mikkelsen, who plays Hannibal.
Yeah, he's really good.
I'm going to say it. He's a better Hannibal Lecter than Anthony Hopkins. It's a completely different Hannibal Lecter. It's not like the funny, charming Hannibal Lecter. It's a completely emotionless, fucked up, weird Hannibal Lecter. But I like him better. It's more fun.
Well, then again, I've only seen Hannibal Lecter in a movie, so I don't know if Anthony Hopkins changed at all in
No, he doesn't really change. He's still just as awesome.
Oh, okay.
But there's an episode where another serial killer, he was like a musician, like is using people's like it might be intestines as like to make cello and violin strings. He runs like a music thing. And Hannibal figures it out, but, you know, he doesn't really want to tell the FBI. Whatever. That dude figures out
I forget why. He goes after Hannibal, and there's literally like a serial killer fight, and it's so fucking cool. And right beforehand, that dude, the new serial killer's friend, is a patient of Hannibal's. Mm-hmm. And he comes in to like talk to Hannibal, like, I think my friend might be a serial killer, all this stuff.
Yeah.
And then that dude walks in and just is gonna kill the dude, and Hannibal just walks up and breaks his patient's neck. Just to basically because he knew that dude was going to kill him. And he was like, oh, this is easier and it saves him more, like, it's less painful, whatever, it gets him out of the way. Mm-hmm. Like, he just literally walks up behind him and just grabs his head and just cracks his neck and kills
Holy
him.
Shit.
It's so fucking cool. Like, and there's no emotion on his face at all. It's,
I just stopped watching this show.
He just proceeds to talk to the other dude, like as if nothing happened.
Hold on for a second. You showed me the first episode, Kyle. How did you show it to me again?
I think I showed you on iTunes, maybe? It was free at the time, though.
All right, I need to look into this show. Oh, this sounds show amazing.
Well, I will say, I think I will have room to check out the show because
now you gotta
watch
Supernatural.
I've officially decided to stop Heroes at season 3 and not watch.
You should
stop
at season 1.
No, I.
No, season 2.
But think about it. Think about it. He doesn't have to watch the carnival.
I didn't watch the fucking carnival. I watched.
That's because you're a soulless bastard.
Oh yeah, I'm a soulless bastard. Didn't watch the carnival. What were they thinking
you
when
quit.
They said, "Oh, we're doing a show of people. It's kind of like X-Men. Let's have fucking Carnival from HBO."
Ray Park was in that season.
Ignore this, Jared.
Don't watch
it. Yeah, I quit.
Because you know why too? When the Tracy Strauss / Nikki chick came back at the end of season 3,
who?
I was just like, not again.
Wait, Ellie Larder did what?
She came
Tracy.
Back, like another character. Like, so you know
when,
like,
yeah,
one
Tracy.
Book ends and they preview the next book?
Yeah, but Tracy, I don't think, ever leaves, right?
No.
Oh, no, she dies.
Nikki dies.
Tracy dies, quote-unquote, like she gets
shot. She turns
into
ice, but she comes back.
Yeah, she's like Hydro bitch. And she
so that was Tracy. Okay,
yeah.
So she comes back.
Nikki dies in the fire or whatever. Whatever, we're talking about, like, a show that ended 5 years ago.
Yeah, it's just a perfect example of a show that was great and getting, like, fell victim to, like,
hands
cliches.
Down, though, man. If they were like, we're gonna make a Siler show, I'd watch every single episode.
I watched Siler carry that fucking show. So
season four is almost worth watching because of Siler.
Yeah.
Here's why I stopped watching it for that reason, because it just became the Siler show, and he lost what made him so cool in the first season.
He did. Yeah. But second half of the third season, when he's searching for his dad and shit.
Too many jokes, too many, you know, too
Yo,
many references.
If you say cake is not the best joke that was ever on that show, I will disconnect you.
I like when, like, they had
You
him
don't
get...
have that authority, Kyle.
Wait, I missed that. Why is he disconnecting
cake?
Me?
If you say cake is not the best joke that was ever made on that show.
Oh, that was hilarious.
When he murders that woman, and then they all
work,
and like, happy birthday! He's like, ooh, cake, with blood all over him.
I like that. He was more powerful. Like, he became a shapeshifter, and like...
That was sort of the moment that it lost me, because that was when he had, like, ambitions. Yeah. Before that, he was just like, fuck it, I'll just kill everyone!
Gave him ambitions. He wanted to find his dad. What else did he want to do?
Who was...
They turned him into fucking Nathan, which is when they lost me. Like,
I kind of like that. I kind of that was the
that
only
was
part
a cool no
four.
That was cool. Like
well, it gets kind of annoying in season 4, but that was the only thing I kind of enjoyed because Siler is still around. Siler's in Matt Parkman's head.
Yeah, which is weird.
Like, cause Matt goes into his head to, like, you know, screw with his brain, and Siler's brain sort of invades Parkman's head.
Mm-hmm.
So Siler has this weird, like, he's like Matt's walking around with Siler kind of talking to him the whole time, and then Siler kind of takes over his body.
Oh, but, is that what happens in season 4?
Yeah, and Siler's body has Nathan in it.
Right.
And like that, they start to be, it starts to unravel, and like there's Siler's mindless body with Siler's mind with Matt Parkman, and there's... Again, Siler is the only interesting part of the series.
Yeah, seriously. Like,
and it's like,
yeah,
they're trying to entice
us
with,
you know,
with
when
players.
You have too much of a good thing, you know, stops being good.
It's like they're trying to entice him with Claire's lesbian phase.
That's my second biggest issue with the show. While I am interested in the lesbian phase,
the girl she's with is not
you're interested in the lesbian phase, then the writers won because that's what they're hoping for.
Pat, they didn't win because I'm not interested enough to watch the damn thing.
Yeah.
Fair. And also, the show's been off for 4 years. The writers very much lost when they got canceled.
That's a pretty damn good point.
Things about heroes that really piss me off. The fact that Hero...
Caitlin!
Yeah, Caitlin, the fucking driving force for Peter Petrelli's actions in season 2.
Where'd she go? I don't think I've ever talked to you about this with Jared. Hang on. Jared, what was your opinion on Caitlin?
Who's Caitlin?
Exactly.
Yes, thank you. The Irish girl.
Perfect reaction.
The Irish girl was the main character of season 2. Like, the main, driving force for Peter.
She kind of just disappeared in the future, right?
Yeah,
she got taken by cops.
I love that he just left her in that post-apocalyptic future.
And then never talks about her again. What, after the end of season 2, never mentioned again.
Never.
And they've literally, at Comic-Con, I forgot who it was, I think it was Tim Krang or Brian Fuller or someone, was like, it's time to move forward, not look back. And they just never mentioned her again!
Right. I wish that they did that with more of the stuff.
I could not agree with you more, but yeah.
I really wish that, if they had just pretended it didn't happen, I would have been okay with that.
Well, the moment that I was like, oh shit, and I think very quickly we have to get off Heroes, because we're talking about a very old show at this point, but...
Not that old.
It ended 2008?
2010.
Really? Wow, lasted that long? But anyway, was when Siler developed empathy for an episode, developed a empathic mimicry for an episode, developed Peter's power, where he gets L's electricity.
Oh, I hate that.
Which makes no sense and is never shown again. Like, he only gets that one power through empathic mimicry. And it's you could argue if at one point he ripped open Peter's brain and looked around in it, you'd be like, hey, he learned it. He didn't know he learned it, but he learned it. But it's that's not his power.
No,
he's not really the Petrelli son. He's a fucking weirdo with, he's fucking, what's his name? John Glover's son.
The, whatchamacallit, Luther from Smallville.
Yeah, he's Lionel Luther. he's Lex Luthor. He's the Lex Luthor of Heroes.
I think we know who needs to play next Lex Luthor in Man of Steel 2.
They can't do that. He's already Spock.
I wonder how many people would get that connection.
Yeah, that'd be a real reach, man.
But one last closing remark from me was that a thing that really pissed me off was that they made Claire a front and center character.
Well, that's the yes, I 100,000% agree. But she was
after the whole save the cheerleader, save the world thing, which was great.
Yeah, you saved the cheerleader, you saved the world.
And then they just needed to move on, and she was a cute face, but just I don't know how she just became the
because
the
she
heart
was the face
and soul
of, the,
of that show.
She was the face of the show. She was on all the magazines. She was she was the media coverage. She was Hayden Panettiere. She was the face of Heroes.
Yeah, save the cheerleader, save the world. You know, that whole motto that ended up
we
not
redid
being
that.
Relevant. Yeah,
that's not true.
Well, I mean,
if they didn't save the cheerleader, Siler would have been immortal.
Future Hero was misled though. He didn't know that Peter was the one that exploded.
Yes, but if they didn't, if Siler would be immortal, that would not be a good thing for
he
the world.
He got her powers eventually anyway.
That was a really long time from then.
Yeah, he did. Well, and then
also,
of course,
it was only six episodes.
Also, one of the best episodes, one of the best moments in that entire series, when he gets Claire's power and is just wandering down the street with the happy music playing.
Yeah, I like that.
And the cops, or the agents show up, and he just looks at them and just sends them flying happily.
Yeah. Cool. And that really weird happy music is playing.
That was the best. That was my favorite moment in Heroes, hands down.
Yeah, because Siler was back after a whole season of being powerless. And
in Mexico.
With
Jose's cousins.
Well, all right. The Mexican.
They were Honduran.
Yeah, I know. You're
the South American characters were awful.
I know.
Yeah.
And Jared, did you realize they're Honduran?
Are they really?
Yeah, the first episode they're in Honduras.
Hi.
I remember that.
They're Jose's cousins, Alejandro and...
Jose, I think
Alejandro
I saw you at that
and
wedding
Maya,
scene.
That's what it was.
Yeah.
It's not. It's Freud. It's Freud that you made that mistake. Don't worry.
Freudian slip.
Pretty much.
That's what I remember. While watching the show and thinking it was weird that Claire's boyfriend West, the flying guy, was actually older than the actor who played Adam Monroe, who was like the big bad.
Is that
like,
true?
Yeah.
He's older than Dave. Yeah. Dave.
What, he's like a year or two older.
What is his name? Dave
Sanders, I think?
Dave Sanders? Oh. So, yeah. Is that his name? That sounds,
I don't know.
That sounds. It's going to bug me. I like that dude.
Oh, yeah, the guy who played Adam?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and then that was my problem, was that they focused on characters like Claire, and then they didn't make enough new characters,
oh,
and
yeah,
characters
Monica,
that needed some more depth, like Adam, didn't get it.
Yeah, no, they did make Adam, and then he was sort of not used well in the second season. Like, he was around, he was what's his name, Kensei, and it was like, the whole Japanese thing went on way too long.
Yeah.
He wasn't interesting as a character in Japan. He was interesting when he was in the modern day. And then
that is true.
And then Arthur sucked his life away and he turned to dust.
That pissed me off.
There was
I remember you crying about that.
There's a scene
like,
in like,
he just dies such a bitch way.
I remember Alex just being like, what? Because Alex watches TV shows 2 years later than everyone. So I remember him being like, I can't believe
that
killed.
I kept up with that. Until that point. Until that point that I cut off.
I remember Alex just being like, they killed Adam.
I distinctly remember like in high school, you and I at the lunch table one day, and this is when Heroes was coming out, and I just found out that Takezo Kensei was Adam Monroe in the present day, and we were trying to tell Alex this, and Alex just could not comprehend that Takezo Kensei.
Did that happen?
That
I don't
really
remember
happened.
I believe it.
At all.
Now, like I mean, very well, I mean, it does not sound out of the realm of possibility.
Okay.
Oh, God. But yeah, there's a scene, especially, I remember in early season 3, where Peter, I think, has like a prophetic dream where like they're in this hallway and Marlo from The Wire rips off Claire's head and everything. And it just shows, I think it was Ali Larder, Knox.
Yeah, they show the villain.
And Adam Monroe chilling with him. If that happened, that would be fucking awesome. Adam Monroe hanging out with like the new villain.
But it could have been, you know, it could have been a reference to like Adam's power that Arthur, you know.
I think that's looking too
changed.
Into it.
No, I mean, there's a lot of things. All those dreams were never on the money. There was never any, you know, there was never any prophetic dreams that were correct. Remember when Christopher Eccleston was in that show?
Yeah, that was good.
I didn't even watch that just for Christopher
Eccleston. Yeah, I know, right? Before I watched Heroes. Yeah. I watched Doctor Who, I gotta go back and watch those episodes.
Oh, yeah, Claude Rains.
Yeah.
I can't wait for Christopher Eccleston in Thor 2. That should be cool.
Yeah, that should be nice.
Yeah.
I just wish you'd actually watch current Doctor Who, you know?
He would?
No, Eccleston.
Yeah, every interview I see with him just fucking pisses me off.
What does he do?
He disregards Doctor Who like it was like a bad kind of hangover. Or
it was just like something.
Why does he regret
it
so much?
I don't know. He like hates it.
To him, it was like a gig he did one weekend years ago.
It seems like that.
Isn't he the kind of actor that just doesn't want to refer to anything he's done in the past?
I think he only says that because of Doctor Who.
Really?
Because I heard him talk. Someone asked. I heard him getting interviewed about Matt Smith, and he was like, "Oh yeah, Matt's a great actor. I've never seen him in Doctor Who, but I've seen him on stage. Like he goes out of his way to be like, yeah, I've never watched it." And just,
really?
Yeah. It just it's so goddamn annoying.
I think he said that he's glad that he played the Doctor as a character and he gave his version, but that's about as far as it goes.
Like, it's just like, all right, you don't have to love it. Nobody's saying you have to love it. But pretend you give a shit.
There's all kinds of rumors about why he left after one series, between him not wanting to be typecast and between him not getting along with the production staff or whatever.
I just don't think it was his kind of show. He's just not that dude.
Yeah, I was rewatching it with my friend. I was showing my friend it, and yeah, he's not the Doctor, really. I mean, like, the Doctor's also...
I love the Doctor.
Oh, really, Alex? Oh, really?
Hold on, wait.
Oh, really?
Wait. I love his rendition of the Doctor. I think it was a very needed.
Yeah, I love
thing
the Ninth
for
Doctor.
I love the Ninth Doctor.
Oh, but this is big. This is big.
Like,
I remember having this argument
with
Alex.
I still like him.
He was the best. He was funny, dark, cool.
But yeah, but he's a very different take on the Doctor.
Exactly. He's a different take, and that's why he's not the best,
that. Like,
but he's still pretty
awesome.
You can't
have the same fucking character every iteration.
But I maintain, I've gone back and watched all his episodes in the last month, because I have more time than seems to be legally allowed somehow. But. He's not funny.
He has moments when he's snarky.
Well,
he has zero funny scenes.
When he dances and the Doctor
dances.
That's not funny.
He's
snapping.
He's funny.
He's doing the Carlton dance.
Oh,
he's
really?
Like,
oh, that's hilarious when he's like, He was not doing the Carlton dance.
He was snapping his fingers, kind of.
Again, like,
whatever.
He was like, oh, Rose, I forgot, I can dance. That's not funny.
What about the scene in Rose where he can't see the Ferris wheel behind him or whatever? He's like, what are you talking about, Rose? Oh, fantastic.
I mean, that was maybe the closest thing, and that's the first episode.
What about the scene where he's, like, scolding the little boy in the gas mask to go to his room or whatever?
It's not really funny.
And the scene where he's like,
why does he have to be funny? Hold on, though. Why does he have to be funny?
Because the doctor's funny.
Not that doctor.
All doctors are funny.
Not mine. Not well, he had scenes like when he's like, he was funny when he had doctor. Like snarky. Not,
first doctor was really funny.
Smart ass comments. Like, this, the first,
how many episodes
episode?
Of the first doctor have you watched, Pat?
Oh, like I've seen, I'm much full. I'm sorry I haven't watched like six parts of one story.
That's what I said. Like, I said, how many episodes have you watched, Pat?
I haven't watched, and there aren't even that many available. I haven't watched any. I haven't watched any first doctor episodes. I'm sorry.
Defensive,
you can't give an opinion until you actually watch it. That's why I don't give opinions about the previous.
Fine.
Eight
first
doctors.
Doctor was hilarious. He makes
was,
Matt
was every doctor before tonight funny in some way.
Everyone was in some way. Yes. Yeah,
the like, second doctor is the doctor who established the doctor's like.
No, quirkiness. That's what he means. Wacky.
Yeah.
The first doctor was funny in a lot of ways.
Wait. There's funny, and then there's wacky now.
No, because there's funny, and then there's like slapstick Looney Tune funny that the second doctor was.
First doctor was like a grumpy
yes,
grandpa.
Yes, he was dryly
man.
Funny a lot of times. Christopher Eccleston is a guy. That show came out in 2005. Do you know what kind of comedy was going on in 2005?
Office, I guess.
I do believe Grandma's Boy came out in 2005.
Exactly. Like, real comedy was going on. Like, when did Anchorman come out? 2004? Real funniness was happening. But if you look at David Tennant, compared to Christopher Eccleston, just comedically.
Yeah,
David Tennant's hilarious.
Well, David Tennant, like, his doctor went through a lot of, like, tragic
even though
stuff,
I do prefer
though.
Him.
But the doctor is a wacky old man that travels around making jokes, fighting, you know.
And towards the end of the 10th Doctor's incarnation, he got more angsty after everything
that
happened.
Yeah, but that made him better. And Ninth Doctor, I love the Ninth Doctor. In his serious, moments,
yeah.
He is almost unbridled. Like, when he's... When,
first
like,
nice thing you said about the Ninth
I
Doctor.
I love the Ninth Doctor. It's when you were like... when it annoyed me when you were like, he's the best!
Yeah, of course, because that's all I knew. I just
I
got
know! That's what I kept telling
you! You know, it's funny when, like... Imagine you're a classic Doctor Who fan, and then you hear the Doctor... After 16 years, Doctor Who's coming back, and then they announce... The doc, you just see this like older guy, like a leather jacket,
yeah,
like
yeah,
brownie
like,
face. Like you must have been like, oh shit, the show is gonna suck.
Yeah.
Now it's like all cool, but you know, once he gave the man doctor a chance,
I mean,
it was
like,
good.
Like what you said, it's he came right after the time war. He was probably all pissed
in
off.
It is serious
it's good
moment.
For the
and
canon.
He was good for setting
canon.
Up a lot too. Like
yes.
He set up the view.
Yes,
he got
yes,
the viewers
yes.
ready for regeneration and everything.
Yes, and in his in Dalek in. The serious moments of the Doctor dances and what was it? What was the other episode with the
Empty Child?
Empty Child. There were in the serious moments. He's almost. Yeah, there's almost nobody that can compete with him. He is unbelievable.
He was the doctor that wouldn't take shit from anyone. I mean,
yes.
All the doctors do that to a degree.
Yeah,
he's
yelled at random people. He's like, shut up and listen to me. Like, he would just say that.
Well,
like,
all,
whoa.
All of them do. All of them don't give a shit.
Yeah, well,
like,
I don't
the
think
the 9th Doctor
ever said, like, somebody to shut up and listen to me, like, with that, besides his companion.
I mean, you gotta get to 11, because 11 is just telling random people to go fuck themselves, basically.
Yeah,
like, one funny moment with the Ninth Doctor, the very first episode, I think when they first meet Jackie Tyler, he's like, she's in her bathroom. She's in her bathroom, like, oh, there's
the
a strange
man in my room. What, anything could happen. He's like, no.
No. that's a funny scene.
I mean, it's funny, but it's not like, I don't know, it's different. So, I mean, Jared, I'm sorry, we're going into Doctor Who, but Alex did just watch recently The End of Time, which is the 10th Doctor's last adventure when he regenerates into the 11th Doctor.
But not the last time we'll ever see him.
Last time we'll see him so far.
In that timeline, yeah.
No, I mean, until, what is it, 2 months from now?
Oh, yeah.
But, so...
I can't wait.
Have you watched The 11th Hour, by the way?
Yes, I did. I watched The 11th Hour.
Isn't that such a good, like, pilot episode for Doctor Who, for, like, new viewers
yeah,
to jump
if you,
on
if you
to?
Just jumped on The 11th Hour, I think you'd be fine.
The way I see
it's kind of like a secondary branding, I think.
Yeah,
it was.
They were redefining the show after 10. The new TARDIS, new companions, and new Doctor, new Sonic Screwdriver.
And I also know that the TARDIS also kind of regenerate.
It did, yeah. It exploded. Like, it needed to regenerate
just like the Doctor.
But, so what do you think of, we'll just go into End of Time, because that's hands down, one of the greatest.
And definitely the most dramatic of the Doctors of Generations. Every other generation just him kind of like falling down and then like turning into the next guy.
Then I just kind of sure was like, hold on, wait 1 second. Wait 1 second. When we regenerate, psh, I'm regenerating.
First Doctor fell down, third Doctor fell down, the fourth Doctor fell down. Yeah. Well, yeah, he died saving someone's life.
But, well, no, he sees his own regeneration like days before it happens.
But the fifth Doctor?
Yeah.
When did this happen?
He sees that white, like, ghosty thing.
Yeah, no, that's the fourth to fifth.
No.
With the Watcher.
The cocoon thing?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, that's what I meant. Yeah, that's what I meant.
And I would hope they would do something like that. They'd have to do something big for Tom Baker after 7 years.
Yeah. That's what I meant, yeah.
Yeah, fifth to sixth was just him saving Perry.
Yeah, and then he chokes her out. Yeah, yeah. That's true.
I did like Colin Baker's first lines, though. Like, Doctor's like, you expecting someone else? Yeah. That's a pretty good line.
But what'd you think of the whole thing?
I thought it was fantastic. I mean, like, well, the second part's obviously better than the first part.
I consider it one long movie.
Like,
things I liked the Doctor's conflict with the Time Lords and the Master coming.
That's cool, I remember asking you that.
Oh, yeah, well, my favorite
part. Joey, he just saw it, I'm asking what he thought, and you're just all like,
right, fine.
Well, guess what I think.
Fine, you know what, I won't say shit about it. You wanna know? I had a really good monologue about my thoughts on the end of time, and now you're not gonna hear it. So, Alex, give us,
Alex's
like, your take on it.
Alex's opinion is worthless here.
It was Pat, by the way.
Well, basically, my favorite part was the Time Lords. I think they were kind of cool. Like,
Timothy Dalton?
Yeah, like, they were kind of, oh, yeah, he was kind of
Timothy
familiar.
Dalton was a Razzler.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was Bond. James Bond.
He's Bond number four, three.
What, for, like, one movie?
Two? Okay. Two, three, maybe?
Yeah.
I think it was two movies.
We don't like to remember those.
Hey, I like the Daltons.
I guess, like, it's the first time you see the Time Lords, and they're kind of like, they're very angsty and they're kind of pissed off at the Time War and shit. And
they
want to get the fuck out.
They're very powerful and they're very pissed.
They're very pissed and they'll do anything. They'll enslave a race in order to get the hell out of there.
And the Master is just this crazy motherfucker.
Oh,
it was weird. They tried to make
everyone's a Master.
Yeah, the Master race.
I like that part. It's like a new race. The Master.
And everyone's like, hello.
Things I didn't like about the episode: the Master race and Russell T. Davies has this. Russell T. Davies can. Midnight showed me that Russell T. Davies can be a great Doctor Who writer.
I watched the episode once.
Oh yeah,
I watched.
You mentioned how weird that episode. It is a weird episode.
Watched every other episode probably more than a dozen times. I've watched Midnight once, and I've never watched it. I don't like it. It makes me uncomfortable. I don't like
it. It is a little creepy.
See,
it has a very creepy. You don't see what the thing is. That possesses
it makes
person.
You feel weird.
It
that's
does.
The
I was
thing.
Like, what's going
it's
on?
It's got all the symptoms of like a bad Russell T. Davies episode, which is what I was going to mention. End of Time is that he introduces all these pointless comic relief characters.
The cactus people.
What? Yeah, the cactus. Yeah. In End of Time, you've got like the horny old lady that's like molesting the Doctor.
I thought that was funny. I like that.
You've got that black kid in like the garbage dump who's a mute, but they don't really develop.
He gets eaten.
I know. Like, what was the point of him except for getting eaten? I mean,
it was nothing. There was no point to him. I like the old lady. I think it's funny because it's like a weird moment of.
That's what should be in the last 10 Doctor story.
It's a weird moment of comedy when like something awful is happening and he's just like, all right. Like awkwardly going along with it when he should be trying to save the world.
Mm.
But I'll give you the cactus people. I didn't really understand the point.
The
only reason they existed was to have the spaceship.
Yeah. Yeah, too. I like, you know, Wilfred was awesome as a companion.
Oh, Wilfred.
Wilfred's the best.
You know David Tennant's son is named Wilfred?
After that guy?
No. I don't know about the guy specifically, but Dave Ten's son just happens to be named Wilfred.
Well, when was he born?
Like the last two or so years or something.
Okay.
I don't know.
No, he had a kid with what's her
Georgia
name?
Moffat.
Yeah, Mrs. Moffat. Miss Moffat.
Surprisingly, not a lot of Donna in the time. Just kind of she
in the background.
She did one thing, and that was it.
Yeah, she almost remembered the Doctor. And
yeah,
died.
She almost remembered. Yes, and that's that. Was
yeah. Then she found another black guy to marry really fast.
That was before that show.
Speaking of black people, hey, Martha and Mickey are black, aren't they?
Yeah, they were. Why are they together?
Because they're black.
Yeah, but still.
Yeah, that was a weird racist thing they did.
Yeah, I was like, why are they together?
Let's take
like
two most
military.
Well,
camps.
Okay. To be fair, if you want to go real specific. Clearly, Mickey couldn't marry Rose. She's in the other universe with the Doctor. With
the other
Doctor.
Uh-huh. Yeah, where was he? Like,
Donna's Rose? Not going to marry Mickey. That would be weird.
Uh-huh.
The only other companion is Martha.
So,
by process of elimination, the only two people left Or the two black people.
Okay.
I mean, like, you didn't have to make bury them. They could give them each a separate ending. Maybe Martha's, like, a head honcho at UNIT or something. Maybe.
Well, she was, and then she went freelance. Mm. But I kind of like that. I kind of like that. Because they are... those two people could never, like, work for UNIT. Like, they travel with the Doctor. They can do anything at any time, no matter what they want. Like,
not anymore. Not without a TARDIS.
No, I'm saying they... But that's their attitude. Like, that's how they learned about the universe. They're not just gonna like work for the government, work for like a military organization. Mm. They're companions. They're used to just going to different planets and whatnot.
Yeah, but
the whole regeneration thing was beautiful.
Exactly. So how he says goodbye to like, I don't remember any other.
I don't
want to
go.
That got to like.
But the reason how he went around like watching all of his friends,
companions.
Every other doctor would like regenerate on the spot.
They don't show you. They don't show you that he goes to every companion he's ever had.
So maybe that's when he saw River Song and cried. Because
in the Sarah Jane Chronicles, the spinoff show, Matt Smith shows up. Matt Smith is there. Mm-hmm. And he shows up and the episode is called The Death of the Doctor, The Funeral of the Doctor. Sarah Jane gets like told that the Doctor died and they're having a funeral for him. At some big plot by weird vulture people, whatever it is. But the Doctor shows up, and it's Matt Smith, and she's talking to him at the end, and she's like, are you, like, you know, was he okay when he went? Like,
oh, he's,
you
know, the other, no,
yeah, the other one. And he's like, or like, did it hurt? And he's like, it always hurts. And there's another companion in that episode, Joe Grant, who was the third Doctor's companion before Sarah Jane. And she's sort of like, confused why like Sarah Jane got to hang out with the Doctor again and got like why he came back for her, and he says he's like, when my last form regenerated, I went and visited everyone I've ever like what traveled with, and you know, just to check up on you and like to make sure, and I couldn't find you because you were all having adventures, yada yada yada, and he basically says that he's always, you know, he's kept an eye on all of them. He's always like checked back with them.
Even if they didn't know it.
Yeah, like, but when he was regenerating, he went back and
well,
it wasn't just those like five or six people. Yeah. He went back and checked everyone he's ever.
Yeah, like from that point on, it was beautiful. But my only like weird part about it before that, the way he inhaled that toxic
radiation.
Yeah, the radiation, yeah, like when I thought he would like die in battle. That's how I assumed he would.
That's the point.
Yeah. That's like, the point is that, you know, the Doctor was never going to go out in battle. The Doctor was going to go out saving one lonely, sad old man.
Yeah, like the whole, like, he will knock four times. They made you believe that was the Master. Everything was actually Wilfred just asking it to be let out of the friggin'.
That was
I saw that scene. He's only in there because he saves some, like, pointless random guy that was in there in the beginning.
Yeah.
Like, could you let me out? I'm only one man. Don't save me.
I mean, that's exactly, you know, that's who the Doctor is. The Doctor could have literally just walked away, saved everyone. Wilfred would have just died. But he's like, I can't.
I guess I can accept.
Of course, and I love his reaction. Like, all right, well, yeah, I'll just leave. Like, because that's what I get to do.
Yeah,
but I don't know. Some people say that like the Doctor's final moments in his regeneration and his first moments in his next regeneration are like what shapes like the next version of the Doctor. Like,
because it's all chaotic and stuff.
Sort of, yeah. Like, Ninth Doctor became 10th Doctor because, you know, he was like happier, and now people can never say he was too old for Rose ever again or whatever.
Yeah.
And then when the 10th Doctor regenerated, the first person he met, he was trying to hold on to himself, so he still like looked kind of like the 10th Doctor, and the first person he met was a little girl, so he became kind of a fairy tale type person. So kind of like the first initial moments like shape who the Doctor's persona is for that incarnation.
Then she becomes weird and kind of slutty.
Yeah.
She's like, yeah, she becomes like a kissogram.
Yeah, which is like almost a whore. Like, almost a stripper.
Yeah,
like,
kind of.
Yeah, so
an implied whore and everything.
No, an implied stripper. I shouldn't have said that. Implied stripper.
That's what I like about the 11th Doctor, is that incarnation is when the Doctor regained, like, a new family. Like, not just companions. He actually had, like, a legitimate family now. Like, Amy and Rory were his kind of weird.
Well, I mean, let's not spoil too much. He just got the
just watch the first episode.
So he's met Amy and Rory.
Yeah,
I love the 11th hour when, like,
the
very end
episode.
You know,
yeah, he shows like all his like,
yeah, when he's like has them and everything, has them like check all.
Yeah, that's
the
when like he
history.
Became the Doctor for like anyone watching it. Just like, so, yeah, I think he was the Doctor that referenced the past doctors the most too, I think.
Yeah, because he, I mean, to be fair, he was the doctor during 50th anniversary.
Yeah, Russell T. Davies didn't reference old Doctor Who a lot. Steve Moffat did it more, I think.
I mean, he did a time crash where David Tennant met Peter Davison.
Steve Moffat wrote that.
Yeah, but it's Russell T. Davies' show. He was the showrunner.
Still.
He had, I don't think you understand what writing is like in England. They have to like go by the showrunner everything. Mm. That's why Stephen Moffat is hailed as like a genius for this generation of stuff.
I just have one question at the end of time. Who is that woman that was giving the messages? Who is that?
The most widely believed theory is that she's the doctor's mother.
Yes. All right. There's the two biggest ongoing theories are mother and wife. That's the only ones that have any... they'll never say.
Nah. Okay.
Do you think? I hope they get the actress who played Susan from the old series, and just have the doctor, Matt Smith, or even Peter Capaldi lay down the road, just show up to
She might be dead.
I don't know. She's probably an old woman now, but I don't know if she's dead. But yeah, because that's a big thing, Doctor Who mythology. The first doctor saying he'll eventually come back.
Oh, I think she is dead actually. Susan, his granddaughter.
Yeah,
she's dead.
The actress.
His whole family's dead.
Oh, Susan the character's
dead. Yeah.
Well, Susan wasn't on Gallifrey when, it got destroyed.
Probably. The Time War was way later than that.
Yes.
She was a Time Lady. I'm sure she went home at some point. Yeah. And they imply his family's all dead.
That's true, yeah.
Except his daughter he doesn't know about.
Oh, that's weird. His daughter. She's dead. I know.
I think they wanted to do a spinoff with that, but never happened. The Doctor's daughter.
One episode?
Yeah. Yeah.
Did she ever come back?
No.
She married David Tennant.
In real life?
Yeah.
So, the fifth doctor
kid together.
Yeah.
Better. Doctor married.
The fifth doctor is the father-in-law to the tenth doctor.
Yeah. Yeah, did you know that the actress is the fifth doctor?
I think it's
daughter?
Always, yeah. Yeah.
And she married
Peter Davison confirmed some type of involvement in the fifth. I don't know what exactly.
I think they're going to have, digital images or something.
I would like it if the old doctor just voice a character. Like Tom Baker's voice is still pretty distinct to voice the villain in Doctor Who.
Or just voice a holographic version of himself.
I could do that, I guess. Yeah, they did that with Arnold Schwarzenegger and
Terminator Tupac at a concert.
Yeah, that's true.
You would do it on Doctor Who with Tom Baker. We gotta get off of Doctor Who do something interesting. Jared, are you still there?
Well, I kind of ran away from a bear.
Oh, man. Well, you know, the Soviet Union will do that to you. They're all bears on unicycles, after all. It must be really awkward for getting through traffic.
I'm sorry. I cut out there. I didn't hear a word you guys said. You guys were talking about bears on unicycles?
Bears on unicycles. Everyone in Soviet Russia is bears on unicycles.
Since when?
Since about 1984, so you should really be seeing a lot of bears on unicycles.
I see.
We've gone outside in a while.
That explains a lot.
I see.
But anyway, so I was reading earlier. I'm totally confused. Insidious 2 came out last weekend.
That was a thing.
Yeah, Insidious Chapter 2 came out last weekend and made $45 million.
Was Insidious 1 even that good?
No.
No, and it got good reviews, surprisingly, but I actually thought it was really bad.
Thank you.
I like Patrick Wilson.
I don't like Patrick Wilson.
No.
I think he's boring, but also, that movie was awful. Why is there a sequel to begin with, and why is the sequel making money? I feel like I've lost touch with the human race. I have no idea.
Kyle, is this really the first time? How many paranormal activities have they made?
But I get the paranormal activity. I get it.
The first one was a real hit, but was Insidious a hit?
No!
No, but do you get four paranormal activities?
How it works. If there's one thing that works, they'll do it 1,000 times. I don't think the first one worked. I think it was a stupid-ass movie with a mildly interesting villain that they just showed in the background.
Yeah.
That weird Satan goat Darth Maul thing.
Yeah, I saw that, the gif of it, the weird guy with, the... Yeah, I know what you're talking
about. Yeah, he was, a weird puppet guy, he had puppets for some reason, too.
He looks like one of, the thugs from Batman Forever, the street punks always are, Dayglo makeup.
I mean, he literally looks like Darth Maul.
Guys, say what you want about Insidious, the budget was $1.5 million, and it made almost $100 million in the box office numbers alone.
I mean, that makes sense, because that movie was fucking awful-looking.
Fucking Warner Brothers would like blow people if they get that.
But
the
thing is, like, when it makes that much profit based on its budget,
I'm aware.
It will clearly make it's a sequel. And personally, I know you guys already know that I enjoyed that movie.
You were fucking crazy. That movie was awful.
I liked
it.
High,
you
got scared by that?
I didn't get scared. I just liked
it. Failed you. It's a horror movie.
Well, I liked it though.
What's the point of watching a horror movie if you don't get scared?
Plenty of horror movies aren't scary.
Why would you watch a horror movie if you're not scared?
If you like to see, like, torture or blood and shit.
All right, well...
You know, there are websites for that, Alex, if you have that interest.
But people like
seeing
that.
I would say torture. I would just say, like, you don't have to, like, have nightmares, but, like, you know, it has like, a chilling factor.
Yeah, no, you gotta get scared. It's a horror movie.
Yeah, it's gotta, like, you know, make you scared. It can't just be, like, gore.
Like I'll be honest, 28 easy, Days you know? Later was a little chilling at times.
Yeah, but there are two reasons to go to a horror movie. In my opinion,
slasher movies, they're not scary. What do people like?
That's not a horror movie. Those are slasher movies.
Yeah, no, Friday the 13th totally revolutionized that into like a semi-comedy.
Yes,
like,
exactly. Those are not
what Scream did. Like they, like,
well, no, those literally turned it into a comedy movie. We're talking about how they originally became comedies. But like, that's completely different. Nobody watches Rosemary's Baby and it's like, oh, I'm gonna watch this to laugh. Nobody watches the original Omen and is like, oh, I'm gonna watch this to laugh. Like, these are movies that, like, demented people. Those were horror movies.
Yeah.
I don't know. I get a chuckle out of Vertigo every now and then.
Vertigo's not a horror movie. It's like psychological horror at best.
Yeah, that's weird. That's not really the same thing.
It's not really a horror. It's just a guy tortured by, like, his thoughts or whatever.
Yeah, but it's kind of, yeah, it's a disturbing, like, it's a movie that'll, like, shake you.
Psycho is a horror movie. Back in the day, I could see that would be scary. You know, like, nobody would see that twist coming.
I mean, The Exorcist, like, ruined people. Have you ever seen the footage of people, like, leaving the theater and throwing up and, like, not being able to deal with it?
Really? I've heard that. It was shocking for the time.
Yeah, I was watching the show about it on like, A&E or History Channel, and people, like, left midway through and couldn't there was intermissions in the movie. Because people need time to, like, deal with it.
Oh, my God.
To process that crazy shit.
It fucked people up.
Wasn't the demon named Pazuzu or something?
Probably.
It is amazing that it can fuck people up like that.
And Night of the Living Dead, when that came out, that apparently was
a scary
fucking movie. And that was hilarious.
It's funny. It only got so much infamy because there's a scene where, like, the zombies are eating, obviously, fried chicken that's supposed to be, like, the two people's bodies.
It wasn't fried chicken. It was chicken. It was not fried chicken.
Oh, it was just chicken. It was clearly
they go out of their way to make it fried chicken.
Yeah, it's not like there's a bucket of Kentucky fried chicken that they were trying to pass off as a guy.
It looks more realistic if it's fried chicken, guys.
But yeah, and then Dawn of the Dead came out and everyone left. I don't know. Horror movies, very few horror movies will do anything for me. Cabin in the Woods was awesome.
I've seen that.
That was about the last quote unquote horror movie that I will give props to.
I unfortunately know what happens,
though,
but I still
I know.
Want to see
it. Because it kind of deconstructed.
Exactly.
Deconstructed
that's what I like.
Genius.
Well, and then based on Cabin in the Woods was The Evil Dead.
Well, what?
It took a lot of... No,
the original one.
Because the Cabin in the Woods took a lot of tropes from Evil Dead. I've noticed that.
Yeah.
Tropes? Alex? Yeah, tropes. Have you been tropes. To TVTropes.com?
Yes.
Okay, I only said that because I didn't know you meant that.
But that's a word?
Yeah, I know what the word
is. Where do you think TV Tropes came from?
Yeah.
Tropes, I guess.
Yeah, it's a word.
It's a word.
But, yeah, I mean, the original Evil Dead's great. The original Evil Dead 2 is even better.
Yeah.
And then every subsequent one.
Army of Darkness? I like both Army of Darkness.
Yeah.
That's what, like, made Ash famous.
Yeah,
it
did.
I think
all those corny one-liners.
Evil Dead
2,
I kind of did like
Evil Dead 2, he's way better. Because he's just fucking crazy.
Wait, you think Evil Dead 2 is better than Evil Dead 1?
No, Evil Dead 2 is better than Evil Dead 1.
I agree with that, because I like Evil Dead 2 better, because that's when Ash goes fucking crazy.
Yeah.
But I still like
Evil Dead 1 better.
But he was barely even himself in Evil Dead 1.
Yeah,
he wasn't the same thing.
He wasn't Ash, he was just some dude.
Yeah, he was an average horror movie character.
And then Evil Dead 2, you just, like, there's, like, trees raping people. Like,
yeah.
Archery, shotgun hands.
That scene where, like, everything's laughing in the house and then Ash starts laughing just, like, sums up Ash's character
it's
so well.
So awesome.
He chops off his hand, like, who's laughing now?
God, I love it.
Yeah, all right. I can see it.
I mean, just, like, Army of Darkness is more of, like, Sam Raimi realized he stumbled upon this campy kind of direction, so he just, like, ran with that. But Evil Dead 2 is the perfect mesh between horror movie and, like, campy movie.
Yeah, I agree. What are we on, by the way, time, guys?
93 minutes.
93? Oh, okay, that's not too bad.
That's too bad.
I got another,
say, 10 minutes here in Siberia before my connection times out.
Right. Spoiler alert, doesn't Ash, like, show up, like, Bruce Campbell shows up in the post-credit scene of, like, the new Evil Dead?
I've heard so.
Yeah, I've heard that.
Where are they gonna go with this? So, wait. It's
Evil Dead 2 is just old Bruce Campbell.
Well, they're making Evil Dead 4, aren't they? Yes, they're making Evil Dead 4.
Sam Raimi wants Evil Dead 4. Was that make Army of Darkness? Like,
I'm so confused.
Wait, but they already remade the Evil Dead.
That's what I'm saying. Evil Dead 1, then Evil Dead 2, then Army of Darkness, then Evil Dead, now Evil Dead 4?
Yeah.
It's the fifth movie.
Well, the remake does not take... There's no Ash, so it's not the same...
He goes in the credits!
Ash shows up after all the teenagers are dead and mutilated and
shit. But this is Sam Raimi doing it.
No, but see, the thing they should do is they should connect that movie to it. And Ash comes up, if this was me making the new Evil Dead, Ash would have came up and just been Ash, like current day Ash. Mm-hmm. And the next movie kind of be a continuation of the reboot, but just have Ash have been alive the whole time. And just goes on to further adventures, like killing the demons that happen in the reboot movie.
It's like at the end of the Fast and Furious 6 or whatever, and Jason Statham from the transporter shows up. It's like connecting.
I heard it's not him. I heard it's just Jason Statham.
Oh, right. Because I was going to say that it's taking what should be the generic action movies and creating, like, a vaguely similar Marvel Cinematic Universe to, like, connect all these action
movies. Well, that's what I was so excited about. I thought it was the transporter. I was like, holy fuck, I would see that movie 1,000 times.
I'm disappointed it's not now. But it's just Jason Statham. That's
it really disappointed me.
I don't know what the next big movie I want to see is, or the next big video game release after GTA 5 or whatever. The only thing I'm looking
games?
Games or movies, I don't really know what
else. I mean, Thor's coming out in a couple months.
Oh, Thor, yeah, that's in November.
Well, yeah, it's Thanksgiving. We have Captain Phillips with Tom Hanks.
Oh, God.
Yeah!
I mean, it's gonna be one of those Oscar movies.
I looked it up. That Captain Real apparently knowingly sailed in pirate-inhabited waters for some reason.
It's a true story. It's just not...
Well, that is
not
silly.
As broke. He just knowingly tried to get caught by pirates.
He didn't knowingly try. He just was not a very good captain.
Yeah. What's that Walt Disney...
You are clearly not a very good captain.
Yeah.
What is it?
Yeah, I don't know what would be next after this.
Thor 2 is in November. Everything else coming out in October. I think you're good. It comes out in September.
Not at all.
Yeah, August and September, like
it's TV months. It's not movie months.
Yeah, that's true.
Speaking of which, have you seen the casting for the Flash guy?
Yeah, I saw. It's just CW Arrow casting their usual pretty boy actors.
No, it's not. It's worse than that. I'm going to give it to him because I hope he's good at it. Because I really want a good Flash show. I think that'd be fantastic if he can pull it off. But the highest credit on this guy's list is Glee.
It's not a good sign.
Oh,
if anything,
shit.
It's the opposite of a good
sign.
And
I was reading about him, and he's a villain on Glee.
A villain? The villain on Glee is just like the asshole bully in school or whatever.
No, apparently he was gay.
Oh, okay.
Apparently he was like a gay douche or whatever. But if he could, I hope that means he was a good actor. That means he was like a villain. Because villains are always... good. Yeah, it's harder to play the villain than it takes to,
I always thought playing the villain would be a lot more fun.
Yes,
it's
better. It takes more chops to play the villain than it does to play the hero.
Yeah.
Mm.
So I'm hoping
Grant Gustin is his name.
Yes, that is his name.
Now he's Barry Allen.
I cannot imagine seeing this dude just from seeing his picture. I cannot see Barry, but
Barry
Jeff Johns had a lot to do with this.
Holy shit, that is not Barry.
Thank you.
Yeah, Barry Allen's kind of a square when you think about it.
Well, first of all, he's only a few years older than us. Like, that's playing Barry Allen.
I think he's literally my age. I think he was born in 1990.
He was, you're right.
I hate it, people our age, like, doing bigger...
I'm okay with them doing bigger things, but, like, if he's gonna be the legitimate Barry Allen, like legitimate Barry Allen's, like, in his mid to late 20s.
No, but dude, check, just hang on.
This dude, he's 23. I'm going to be 23 in a few months. He's a few months older than me. Barry Allen, Superman and Batman started their careers as Superman and Batman when they were 25. Mm-hmm. That's only 2 years from now. Mm. I only have 2 years to become a superhero.
Mm.
I mean, like, I don't know.
Wow, you just threw that one out there. That's psychological.
But that's my point, is that 23 is not really that young to be playing Barry Allen. In the grand scheme of things,
23 is like Wally. If you're playing Wally West, it's not that young.
Well, Wally West started when he was like 14.
Well, fair enough.
So.
Well, I mean, it depends on how old they make him look. Like, you know, what they'll usually do in Hollywood is like, if someone's gonna be playing someone in their mid 20s, the actor will be in their 30s, like, and so on and so forth.
But
down, like, this guy is 23. He could play a kid who's in high school.
I mean, he was in Glee.
There you go.
Yeah, they better put Barry Allen as a
And now he's supposed to be playing someone who's 4 years older than himself. Like, those are always
tough.
They're
not going to Keystone City High School.
No, he's playing a police. He's playing a forensic scientist for the Keystone Police that comes to Starling City searching for some criminal that has some background with his own past.
Maybe it's his mom being killed.
It might be something like that. But they're making him a comic book fan, like a comic book fanboy, that's Barry Allen. Barry Allen was a Flash fanboy. That's why he has the name The Flash.
How did he never get sued for that anyway in the universe?
Because in the Silver Age, the Golden Age didn't exist. It was different universes. It was just a comic book.
But yeah, like, the comic book creators could say, hey,
are you gonna sue a superhero?
Yeah, that's true, I guess.
How are you gonna sue him? He doesn't have you don't know his name.
Yeah, I guess that makes sense. But
DC's suing the Flash.
So he's starting off on like a couple episodes of Green Arrow, then going to his own spinoff.
Yeah, that's what it's looking like. And apparently he gets his powers on Arrow.
That's good. I mean, how do you think they're gonna delve into like the Speed Force? Well, probably if
On the show, they will. On this individual show,
they'll probably just get the powers on Arrow, then like delve into the Speed Force and eventually.
No, yeah, I mean, he's gonna have powers on Arrow. They said that.
Yeah,
but yeah, they'll probably delve into his story.
Does he already have his powers?
No, he starts without him. I think he gets them on Arrow.
I've seen a lot of people petition to make, if they make a DC comic cinematic, which they're desperately trying to, but they should make Arrow.
Highlight desperately about 7 times and put that in bold. Yeah.
I would be fine with that.
And underline that.
Because you could have...
And italics.
Yeah, but you can have...
And red font.
Yes, yes. Well, you can have Arrow, because it's not, you know, it's not crazy. It's not out of the ordinary. It's not. You could definitely have that a part of it if they needed to. And then you have a TV show that starts with it instead of adding S.H.I.E.L.D. Like,
next week, S.H.I.E.L.D. comes on.
They are advertising
crap
out of
Thank
that.
Thank God, because...
Awesome.
Like, I guess ABC can't fault, like, you know, that. If, you know, God forbid it gets canceled like every other Whedon show.
No.
But, like, they'll be like, hey, at least we marketed it.
Okay.
You know?
Let's put an end to this. Every Whedon show gets canceled.
Okay.
Buffy and Angel went for 7 and 5 years, respectively.
Well, Buffy got Switch Network.
Doesn't matter. That's a Whedon show that went for 7 years. And Angel went for 5 years on the same network.
There's also a critically acclaimed sci-fi drama that went on for one season and one movie.
Wow. That was one thing that happened, and then a bunch of And then Dollhouse. That was it.
They only gave Dollhouse a second season because of Firefly, and they didn't want to piss people off. That's specifically why they gave him a second season.
There's one show that got canceled after one season. That's what you're talking. That's what everyone's like. The Whedon shows get canceled, and there's one.
Yeah, but that one.
Yeah, like, who cares? I'm sorry, it was an okay show.
I can't tell if you like Firefly or don't like Firefly.
I like it. It's not this messiah of television that everyone seems to think it is. Buffy was 1,000 times better, and it deserved all it got.
There are times where Buffy, like...
Buffy never had a bad season. Not once.
Season 6?
No.
Really?
Season 6 was arguably one of the best.
Yeah. I mean, people, like, gave it shit for, like, you know, magic being an addiction or whatever.
That was that was one of the best parts of the show, is it made it realistic.
Yeah.
And Willow became the... Willow, of all people, was the big bad that almost destroyed the world.
Yeah,
that was crazy.
Cool, like that.
Now, would you say it's worth it for someone to watch that Buffy movie from, like, the early 90s?
But watch about 4 or 5 seasons of the show beforehand, so then you could just look back at it comedically.
Yeah.
Don't watch
whimsically.
It. Yeah, don't watch it and be like, I don't want to watch Buffy now. This movie's awful.
Remember when they were talking about making a new Buffy the Vampire Slayer movie?
And everyone was like, no.
Yeah, and then they were like, let's make a Doctor Who movie. And then they're like, no.
Well, you know what? I think the BBC was like no, because they were getting up to the 50th anniversary. Yeah. And they're filming, like, I think there was an idea going around. Chris Columbus was like, I'll do it. I did Harry Potter. I'm a god. And they were just like, dude, we have plans. Stop it. God.
We have plans.
Don't we always?
So, the only other thing I can think of movie-wise, I said before we got on mic, but apparently Arnold Schwarzenegger is set to play the villain in Avatar 2.
Really? See, now, is he going to be like a... Do you think the cast was like another... corporate bad guy? Like, I hope
he's a giant angry avatar.
Exactly. Yes, he needs to be. He can't play a corrupt corporate guy. He needs to be like a rumble tumble, like, action bad guy, you know?
I hope he's a green dog,
something that involves the less talking the better, you know, for Schwarzenegger.
He's got to be one of the Na'vi or like a different planet,
right? Maybe there's like Na'vi. You know, there's, like, different races. No,
it's supposed to take place underwater, like, the seas of Pandora.
You didn't know about that? They've been talking about that for years.
Friggin' Pandora, the islands are floating. Now they're going underwater.
Well, they showed the people at the beach. Yeah,
they already made a South Park episode on him, like, filming underwater.
Yeah, because he's all about, like, submarines and shit.
Yeah.
So, about finding out what's below our...
James Cameron only makes movies that begin the letter A or T.
True.
Think about it. Terminator, Titanic, Aliens, Avatar, True Lies.
Holy shit.
No, don't give him credence.
I can see you're looking at me like there's no way you're right about this. I'm looking at his
filmography.
Why would you even say something like that?
Why?
It's true. Wow, I didn't realize
you read it online. Well, it doesn't mean like, hey, he only does. It's like, yeah, I'm sure James Cameron.
It doesn't mean it's not true. Like, just because
I only do two things.
Rambo First Blood Part 2. He did, apparently.
Yeah, he did do that.
Do what?
He did the sequel to Rambo.
Wow, I'm sorry, I forgot the sequel to fucking Rambo.
Well, it throws out your whole thing.
Whatever. That's like freaking David Fincher doing Alien 3.
That doesn't matter!
Sanctum in 2001.
Whatever. Stupid Rambo 2.
Rambo 2 kicked ass.
Never saw any of the Rambo movies.
You ever saw First Blood?
No, I just never was into it.
Are you serious?
No, I never saw...
First Blood is absolutely amazing.
I saw the ending where it's like, you know what? I want, like, that guy to be okay or something. I don't know.
That's not what happened.
He was just doing a monologue about something.
No, he was he was held up in a gun store because he just killed, like, 1,000 people, aka, like, 6 sheriffs. And he was getting surrounded, so he held up, and then they brought in his old commanding officer to talk to him, and he had a breakdown from Vietnam.
What year?
Like, my room's all over
What
me.
Year did he make Rambo 2?
I don't know. 1978?
Rambo
yeah,
2
that's the
no, no, Rambo. Oh, was
Rambo
2?
85.
Yeah.
Oh, and also James Cameron. Oh my god. I don't even know if I want to say
Aquaman.
This.
Aquaman.
Spider-Man.
No, he directed Piranha Part 2, The Spawning, in 1981.
hi, bust the A&T myth.
Oh. Reach in 1988. Earthship.tv. 2001,
yeah,
Dark Angel.
All of these movies, aside from Rambo 2, are
Expedition Bismarck in 2002.
These are all like documentaries, not
Ghosts
actual
of the
films.
Abyss,
a documentary.
2003,
documentary.
Battle Angel, ?? The Informationist.
That doesn't even sound like a thing. That just sounds like some random guy editing his page.
Can you believe there's literally an Avatar 4 planned in 2018.
Yeah, they haven't made 2 or 3 yet. Avatar 1 came out like 4 years ago already.
And nobody cares!
I don't care. I felt bad for not liking Avatar when it came. I saw Avatar after I had just like, I'm saying this on a live mic, after I had just like smoked weed and everything. And I saw it in 3D, like one of the front rows after smoking weed, and I still couldn't enjoy Avatar. And I felt bad for not enjoying it, because I could tell, like, they put a lot of effort into making this movie, but I felt bad for not liking
it. Guys, I feel bad.
You try really hard.
Exactly. I feel bad for not liking something they tried really hard to make. Oh, well. But, yeah, just...
Yes, because Cameron needs our sympathy. He's never had success before Avatar.
Yeah, Avatar is, like, the highest grossing movie of all time, I think. Like,
yeah, and who owned the highest grossing movie before that?
Yeah, Titanic. James Cameron before that. But damn, I don't know. Like, and he said that he's so gung-ho about Avatar also. You know, he said that he's only making Avatar and Avatar-related movies now.
Really?
Yeah, like, I don't know. He's only doing Avatar stuff, unfortunately.
Because it makes moolah.
It makes money, but like, it doesn't seem like a movie that would have a universe. It just seems like a one-time stand. I mean,
I never liked Sam Worthington either. I didn't like him in Terminator Salvation. I didn't like him in Avatar. It wasn't even been in since Avatar anyway. Sam Worthington hasn't done jack.
I don't like the actor either.
What?
I don't like the actor.
Sam Worthington?
That's the actor,
Sam Worthington.
I know who you're talking about, though. His name is Jake, right? Jake something or other.
The character's name.
Yeah. I don't know,
Jake Sully.
Yeah, Jake Sully.
Jake Sully.
They had that fucking guy from Dodgeball in Avatar also, but like...
Oh, yeah.
I've never seen Avatar, so I really can't make a joke about this.
Like the only person. Like,
oh my god, yeah. I don't know his name.
Yeah, but... I don't know his name either. I just know him as the fucking guy. He's the bad guy from Grandma's Boy, I think.
He was in School of Rock, too.
Yeah. No, that was Mike White. I don't think it was the same. They look similar, but I don't think they're the same guy.
You sure?
Mike White. He's like blonde and everything. That's Mike White. The other guy's like a brunette. They have the same kind of like, you know, stereotypical nerdy face, but like, I think they're two different people.
If that's the case, they are insanely similar.
Yeah.
If you are correct, Pat, what would I do without you?
I tell people this the same day. Same thing every day. Like, I don't know what they'd do without me.
Jesus, man.
Yeah. Crazy. They had the School of Rock, like, 10th anniversary reunion or whatever recently. Like, all the kids are growing up.
Why does that movie get a reunion?
I actually did enjoy that movie very much.
Maybe the cast production the need for a reunion.
Got along well. I don't know.
Yeah. Maybe. I remember seeing School of Rock when I was a kid, too. It's hard to believe it was 10 years ago already.
Jesus fuck.
I remember when I found out that Jack Black was in Tenacious D when I was in high school. I was like, Jack Black, the actor's in a band?
Yeah.
And then I listened to like Tenacious D and I was like, wow, he's actually really good.
Yeah, I disagree.
What?
Well, Tenacious D.
Are you just disagreeing for the sake of disagreeing?
Yeah, I think so.
No, I'm disagreeing because you said something.
That's exactly what I said.
That's usually how it goes.
No, because if it was someone else saying something, I wouldn't have disagreed.
We were talking about Avatar. We were talking about how the guy from Dodgeball and Mike White, the guy from School of Rock, look similar, but they're not the same guy. And then we moved on to School of Rock, the 10th.
The anniversary
and everything. Yeah.
Did you see that picture?
With all the
cast members.
Yeah.
And that one girl looking at, what's her name?
Miranda Cosgrove.
Miranda Cosgrove is just like, oh my god, it's Carly. Like, there's one girl clearly in the picture just like, oh wow, I remember her. I'm so happy to be in this picture.
Oh god.
And clearly Jack Black is thrown to the side because nobody gives a shit about him.
I like Jack Black. I don't know why people dislike Jack Black. I saw that movie, what was it? He played,
I enjoyed. Fuck, was in that movie. I enjoy Tenacious D.
Yeah, Tenacious D is cool. What's the name of that? Bernie. Yeah, Bernie. I like Bernie. It was a good dark comedy. Sorry. It was a good dark comedy.
Tropic Thunder. I thought he did a
good
job.
Tropic Thunder was good.
Yeah, but that's, you know. I don't think he was the reason why that movie was awesome.
Yeah.
But he did do a good job in it.
He did.
But, yeah, like I said, Ben Stiller's a good director when he wants to be. Like, I like Tropic Thunder for its, like, satire, like, you know, Hollywood films. I like Zoolander. I didn't like Cable Guy, though.
Well, see, the thing is, it's not even so much him as a director, whatever. He just can't, he has to play outrageous characters, or else he sucks.
Yeah, I would agree, like, he has to be, like, the character in
whatever he plays, like, Tropic Thunder. Like, hey, I'm the wacky guy, I'm the regular guy that wacky things happen to.
Yeah, not so.
It's like, he's good in Meet the Parents, that's about it, like.
Not at the museum, didn't really. Wasn't
like, that was fine, but that wasn't so much about him. Yeah. That was like Robin Williams playing Teddy Roosevelt. Like, but when he's Derek Zoolander, when he's like that weird Mexican guy in Anchorman, when he's
Him in Heavyweights and him in Dodgeball is pretty much the same person. But
yes,
like, yeah.
When he's in Dodgeball slash Heavyweights.
Yeah.
Even when he's Starsky in Starsky and Hutch, like, it's, you know,
He's in Royal Tenenbaums, and I was...
He was okay. Yeah. That movie was fucking crazy.
Yeah, it's my favorite Wes Anderson movie, definitely.
Yeah. I would say he was the reason to watch that movie.
Really?
What? Ben Stiller?
In Royal Tenenbaums?
Yeah, I don't think he was the reason to watch Royal Tenenbaums.
You don't think he was?
No, I do not think he was.
No, he wasn't. No. But,
It was a large...
Yeah, it was like the whole...
Man.
The ensemble, it's like ensemble cast, the movie. It's like the precursor for Arrested Development, pretty much. But,
yeah, good point.
But, what else is there?
So, just to put us in some kind of time thing before we go, Breaking Bad has 2 more episodes to go.
Yeah, and you...
You're forgetting one thing.
Really?
What?
What other show is ending in 5 days?
Dexter.
Yes.
I just said that, yeah, Dexter is 1 episode left. I've seen 2 episodes. Me and my cousin are still trying to plan a day to marathon the whole thing. Nice. I think he's waiting. I think he's put me off. I think he's waiting for, I think he's waiting for Breaking Bad to end, because then he'll have something else to watch after Breaking Bad ends, because he loves it so much.
Yeah, it'll be depressing when they're both gone.
Oh, did we talk about the spinoff show?
Saul, yeah.
Better Call Saul?
Pretty good. It's gonna be a prequel and everything, but
yeah, prequel.
I like Bob Odenkirk. Like, Pitcher show's really good.
I don't even like Breaking Bad, but I was like, Bob Odenkirk got a show?
Yeah.
Oh, this rocks! Like, I love that dude.
I saw like a spoof, like introducing like the cast of Breaking Bad when they got to Saul. They were like half of Mr. Show and everything.
Oh, that's awesome! God. Mr. Show is so great.
It is. Oh God. I just love the fact that David Cross, Bob Odenkirk, and Tom fucking Kenny were all on a show together at one point.
Tom Kenny's hilarious. Yeah, you really hear him. Like, Tom Kenny, for all those who don't know, the voice of SpongeBob SquarePants.
Yeah.
Okay.
He's a comedian.
Yeah.
I'm unfamiliar with that show.
Okay.
But he's a real comedian, and I love, he was on the Nerdist podcast, and I love he was talking about how when the Elmo thing happened,
the puppeteer.
Yeah, when
that was messed up.
Tom Kenny was going to fly somewhere, and TMZ like came up to him because I guess like SpongeBob, like it's another kid's thing. He's like, what do you think about the Elmo thing? And I heard him talk about it. He was just like, I had so many rape jokes going on in my head that I was gonna throw out to the TMZ guys, but I was like, you're SpongeBob, you can't do this. Nickelodeon will not be happy.
Yeah.
No, they wouldn't.
He's definitely like one of the top voice actors I'd want. The top voice actors I'd want, like, yeah, John DiMaggio, Tom Kenny, Kevin Conroy. If for female voice actor, I guess I don't want to say
Kevin Conroy. Who does he do?
Kevin Conroy,
some asshole.
Batman.
Yeah.
Oh. You know who? I'm sorry. I literally had the worst brain fart. I thought you meant Kevin Connolly from Entourage.
Oh, that would be so cool!
He's my favorite. Obviously, character. We know who Kevin Conroy is.
Duh.
Yeah, Kevin.
I was reading on Huffington Post. Keep thinking. Well, what you were gonna say? But I was reading on Huffington Post. It was like Entourage movie gets another roadblock. I was like, nobody cares. We're done with that show. Unless you're going to put out the Aquaman movie starring Vince Chase. Nobody cares.
I don't know, maybe just Mila Kunis, just for the sake that she voices Meg. That's about it, but she's still pretty hot.
You know what's weird? I was in class yesterday, and I ended up drawing characters for a kids animated show about, like, a city hall. It's basically like Spin City in, like, a cartoon world. I was, like, drawing, like, the mayor's, like, a bulldog.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and, like, I had, like, his, like, his deputy mayor was, like, a little bird, sort of, like, a Zazu character.
Oh, yeah.
And then, it was just really weird. I was just doodling the whole time. I came, like, a monkey that has, like, a camera that's, like, a reporter, and he's always trying to get, like, he's hanging from places trying to get, like, pictures and stuff.
That's cool.
Yeah, I was really bored.
Oh, God. Damn.
Alright, I think we're running a little long now.
Yeah, we definitely have like 2 hours at least.
Kind of running on steam at this point.
Yeah,
it's fair enough. This is fair enough time to call it a night.
Yeah.
Alright, well, next week we'll come back. Jared will have a game. Maybe Dave will be here. We'll talk about some things that aren't 6 years old.
Hey, 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 it needed to be said.
It did. But, and you know what?
Things,
you're,
there were some air,
it,
things
you know,
in the
it's impressive seeing as you're back in 1985 anyway.
Mm.
I'm surprised Soviet Russia had Heroes Season 3.
they don't have much, but they have that.
Yeah.
He's using my TARDIS in order to see that, what he can.
That and Final Fantasy, only Heroes Season 3 that and is, Final
yeah,
Fantasy
I mean,
1.
Does anything sound like more torture? Just Heroes Season 3, right. Nothing else.
You had to start from that.
Didn't
even see 1 and 2, you only seen the bad
part. I like parts of 3.
I like Volume 4 in Season 3, but earlier stuff.
Oh, well. Well, before we go, I'd just like to say thank you to Jared for calling in from your time phone. And,
it is a pleasure, as always.
And,
indeed it is, my
beware
friend.
Beware of the weather, the bears, and the angry communists.
Oh, I will be running.
All right. Well,
I will be running in the snow.
I feel like I came up with a sign off last week that I can't remember.
I can't remember it either.
How about I try mine?
No, you know what? No. You know what? Jim was the one that had a sign off last time.
I don't know.
Because he made a very in-depth point of our location of it being the brand new old-fashioned lesbian flamingo farm annex at Deer Park and the BKT house.
At Just Casting Studios.
Oh, yeah. From all of us at Just Casting Studios and all that. But yeah, that's too long anyway. Alex, give us a sign-off phase. Have a good week, everybody, and...
Bye.
Wow.
You lame motherfucker.
You're the worst.
I know.
You could end it. No, we're cutting off at you're the worst.
Transform and roll out.
That's all,
folks. Hey, this is copyrighted.
True.
Also copyrighted. Hate you, Alex.
We love all of you that listen to this podcast.
Can't say happy birthday.
Good night.
Happy birthday to you.
What the fuck?
That's copyrighted.
You know what? I'm going to cut this off short.